You have reached Deception Detection Radio with K from the Deception Detection Network. Please stay online while I connect you to the truth.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Deception Detection Radio. I'm Kay. I trust you all had a blessed week. I would like to thank you all for tuning in to tonight's special edition. 52 years ago today, Friday, November 22nd, 1963, at 12:30 p.m. Central Standard Time, America would be changed forever as President John F. Kennedy and his wife, First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy's motorcade toured Dallas, Texas's Dealey Plaza. Three shots rang out, two striking President Kennedy, the first through his neck and exiting striking Governor John Connally, who was sitting in the front seat directly in front of President Kennedy. The second shot went through JFK's head and traveling through his body. James Tague, a bystander, was also wounded. Connally and Tague survived. President Kennedy, however, was pronounced dead at the emergency room. A lone gunman was held as the sole perpetrator for the slaughter of one of America's most beloved presidents. That man was Lee Harvey Oswald, who claimed he was just a patsy. Upon leaving police headquarters to enter a police car to take him to jail, while in handcuffs, a man named Jack Ruby stepped up and fired one shot to the abdomen of Oswald as people around him looked on, the bullet killing Oswald. An investigation riddled with discrepancy and controversy was done by the Warren Commission, yielding findings that never answered the questions that America had been waiting for. Several other committees have been formed through the years, many with findings directly in contrast to the Warren Commission. The records and documents concerning the killing of JFK were to remain sealed until November 22, 2013. That's 50 years. It's now 52 years later, and the truth about JFK's death still remains sealed. Tonight, joining me to discuss the assassination, new discoveries, and why the files are still closed is a very special returning guest, my brother in Christ, John B. Wells. John was a Saturday night host on Coast to Coast AM radio, who now is heading his own radio broadcast, Caravan to Midnight. John has done television and radio announcing, commercials, movie voiceovers since he was a teenager. He is someone that I have respected and admired for years for never seeming to find any topic too controversial. He'll dig into it for the truth. A man who says what he thinks and means it. Everyone, I'd like to welcome back to Deception Detection Radio, John B. Wells. Welcome, John.
Thanks, Kay. It's good to be back with you. How are you?
I'm wonderful. I'm extremely happy to have you on with me. How are you doing?
Well, pretty good. There's certainly plenty of fertile ground out there for little items worthy of investigation. But, you know, it really all goes back. I mean, the turning point, the first domino to fall was really President Kennedy. You know, this may sound a little melodramatic, but I'm still upset about it because it's just amazing how after all these years, many people, and they're smart, some of them are very smart, very analytical people, they're just not prepared to accept what all of the evidence points to, and that is that not only was Lee Oswald, I like to put it this way, we don't know who shot President Kennedy, but we feel certain that we know who didn't, and that would be Lee Oswald, CIA officer.
Totally agree with you on that, and I agree. America, it changed that day, and I was only almost 2 years old, but even as growing up, I knew that America would have been so different if Kennedy would have stayed alive. We wouldn't be dealing with what we're dealing with now.
I completely agree, although that was, it's very interesting. It's written in Scripture that nobody sits in authority that the Father doesn't put there. And right. It could be that I mean, this may be a little bit of a stretch even for me, but it could very well be, because I do not know the mind of Father. I don't, and never will. But it's almost as though he was put in a position of being a sacrificial lamb, if you will, because there were just so many entities, let's say, that were against him going all the way through his presidency, because he was making changes, and these changes were not the sorts of changes that were wanted by what is now known as the global cabal. And I certainly don't call them the elite. I call them the dregs of humanity, not the elite. They are the cabal.
That's a good word for it. I would like to go ahead and say the prayer before we get much more into this, because I think once we get started, we're really going to be rolling with it. So if that's okay.
Absolutely.
Okay. Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much for all your blessings and bringing us back together again today. And please look over the audience and look over John and me. And I want to thank you too, Lord, for bringing John back to Deception Detection Radio. And just to guide the program tonight, let your words be spoken. Let us talk about the truth and just try to figure out, Lord, what is going on and what happened and why. Help us to expose things that people have not heard before. And just put that hedge of protection, Lord, around all of us as we go through tonight's program. And please bless it and lay your hands upon it. I pray this, Lord, in Jesus' almighty name. Amen.
Amen. Well, it's funny. Last night, I was almost having a conversation with myself, and I pulled myself up short and said, what are you doing? And then I realized that only in the middle of the night could I mean, if I had a studio right there and was able to just, like, throw a couple of switches and put all of this into a recorder, I don't know. So it's really interesting. When you call upon that which you should be serving, that which is outside yourself, which is, in fact, your creator,
mm-hmm.
It's amazing what comes out of your mouth if you say, let everything that I say be acceptable to you, to my family, to my audience, and to myself, in that order. It's amazing if you just let yourself go and just kind of tap into, it seems like every person is really two people, that whole duality of man thing. But
sure.
I think it is possible to reach the real self, not the one that people meet when you go to the store. And you know, you're nice or whatever, or they think you're a jerk or whatever that is, whatever it happens to be. And but I think that every person has this inner self, and I'm sure a few would disagree. And when you ask that, what you do serve him, and when you understand that we're not put here just to freelance and do whatever we want and serve ourselves and maybe get around to serving somebody else at some point, maybe help them out a little bit or something,
right.
But you're here to serve your creator. It's really amazing. If you say it and you mean it, and he knows that you believe it and that you mean this, and you don't have to pray about the same thing over and over and over again. He hears you the first time. And sometimes what we want, it takes a minute to organize those things. It may take a long time, because some things have to move out of the way. Some things need to pass away before you can get to where you are directed to go.
Yeah.
It's not like sometimes it's snapping your fingers quick. And sometimes, as one of my friends put it once, if the Lord told us, I mean, the Lord said, it's going to be great beyond your wildest imagination. It's going to be so good, you'll scarcely be able to believe it, even though it's happening to you. But it will take 29 years for this to happen. Would we cooperate? And I thought, you know, that really is a good one.
Oh, that is.
But back to this thing last night, I was just thinking, you know, I wouldn't want to go into one of these diatribes and just condemn everyone without meaning to, but just through what was being said rather than my intention. If I were to release such a conversation that I was having, I don't mean I was wandering around, you know, babbling stuff, but it was you know, it was really kind of an indictment of ourselves. It's not an accusation. It's really more of an indictment. It's like, listen, regardless of the reasons behind it, you were there when the bag was taken, so to speak. You were there. You saw this happen, and you didn't do anything about it. And I think that because then I thought, you know, a lot of people just don't know how to engage. They don't know what to do. They start, and then their heads start being flooded with thoughts of, well, all these what ifs. You know, what if I get into trouble? What if I put a family member at risk? What if I'm wrong? You know, what if I'm wrong and I go out there and I make a big jerk out of myself? And then what happens is, or worse, I mean, let's not even use language that coarse. Make a fool of yourself. And what if it turns out that I'm wrong? But you can't let any of that stuff stop you.
No.
You either have your mission and you're willing to execute that mission, or you're not.
But that's the stepping out in faith. That's
yeah.
The total trust of the Lord when you're able to step out of that comfort zone and know that He is going to have it all under control.
Indeed. It seems like it should be easier because we all know that we're going to have to pass from this world one day. But still, there's something in us that's like, well, maybe if I just kind of go along, maybe I can buy, what, a little bit more time? It's really like what William Wallace said in Braveheart, as depicted by Mel Gibson. It's like, you know, you'll live for a while, but then you'll look back on this going, you know, I could have been part of the freedom movement, and I didn't. I didn't join it. I just stayed here and hid and just hoped for the best without taking any action. And, you know, you reach a point in your life where no matter what age it is, whether it's in your 20s or your 30s or your 70s, where most people decide, you know, I put in all this time down here, but I really wish that I had engaged in something a little more meaningful in order to leave this place in a little better condition than it was when I got here. And so that's what... That's kind of our credo. I mean, our little motto is make ready for what's to come. But
Right. But
really, it's more like awareness, analysis, and then action.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, you don't want a life full of wasted opportunities.
No, and those opportunities are everywhere, and they're where you least expect them. And you just have to be... I heard something silly one time, a long time ago, and it was that if you do not expect the unexpected, it will never find you. And so I thought it was kind of worth holding on to. I don't know how deep it really is, but it's sort of like, yeah, be open to the unexpected, because when it pops up and it finds you because you're willing to let it find you, then a whole new dimension of your life can open. And it's true. It makes no difference what the size of your bank account is or anything else. None of those things.
Yeah.
What color you are, where you're from, your background, none of these things. Not even your level of education makes no difference. There's a big difference between education and wisdom.
That's true. And you can make a difference no matter who you are. Any walk of life, you can make a difference.
Yeah, you know, I say this a lot, Kay, that people, myself included, we want an answer to our questions. We want a good answer. We want it right now. But it's not always possible to get the whole, complete answer. But it is possible to get parts of your answer. In my experience, the Lord very seldom just tosses out the whole deck in front of you and goes here, you know, deal with this.
Mm-hmm.
He tosses out one card, and then another card, and then another. And then by the time you look at your hand, you go, Was I just dealt a straight flush? This is unbelievable, you know. So
right.
You just have to be willing to serve, and if He knows that you're willing to serve, then He'll call upon you, and the reward of service. You know, we heard this when we were kids until we were blue in the face, and we didn't get it because nobody really amplified it to us. But being of service, I like to say there is nothing more inspirational than seeing a powerful and mighty knight with that sword and all that gear on, take that helmet off and hold that sword and ask and pray for guidance.
Amen.
That is inspirational. You know what I mean?
Yes, I do.
So
very much so.
Take us wherever you want to take us.
Well,
and I'll follow you.
I know that you know quite a bit about the Kennedy assassination. That's something that you've really been interested in as long as I've heard you, and the way, you know, I've heard you speak, it's something that you've really investigated. And I'd like to go back to that day and talk about the things that happened and things that led up to the Kennedy assassination and why there's so much controversy still and why we can't get the answers.
Well, I think the reason that they've decided after 50 years not to release the information is because some of the players are still alive. And I believe that it's the same thing as, forgive me now if I seem to go off the trail a little bit, it's the same thing like with these Benghazi hearings. I can't prove what I'm about to say, but it is my opinion that the reason that those Benghazi hearings with Hillary Clinton were as lame as they were on both occasions is because she has so much dirt on everybody. I mean, that it's better to sometimes to ask questions than to make statements. So do we believe that she has so much knowledge about where the bones are buried? She has so much dirt on all of these people up there on Capitol Hill that maybe they think she might roll over on them if they were to come too hard against her. I would think that's a resounding yes. She's not going down by herself. She'll take a bunch of them with her.
That house of cards.
Obviously. Yeah, I mean, absolutely. That's just the word. It's like, or the term. If there were some questions that were not asked that should have been, I'm sure those people are intelligent enough to know what those questions are, and yet they were not asked. And it's the same thing with the Kennedy assassination. I believe that if all of these various facets that of that event, all the components were put together, they would lead directly to people who are currently in power,
mm-hmm.
and to agendas which have been set forth decades ago, which have carried forward or been carried forward unabated since that day. I really believe that the you know that song, the sweater song? I think it's by Weezer. If you want to destroy my sweater, pull this thread as I walk away.
Yeah.
The assassination of President Kennedy is that thread, and that sweater will be unraveled, and the wearer will be completely naked by the time that thread is pulled all the way. And I think that's what we have going here. That's exactly why it's covered up. I mean, when John Connolly called out, "Oh my God, they're going to kill us all," why would he say such a thing if it were just one shot or two shots?
That's true.
He wouldn't. He would only say that. It's just my opinion. I wasn't there in the car. But it seems to me that the only reason you'd say something like that is that bullets were flying all over the place.
Yeah, there are definitely
multiple locations.
Was more than the three. And they didn't come from the book depository.
No. No, they didn't. I mean, people, and you know, the thing that really annoys me is that people in the alternative media, well, not necessarily people in the alternative media, but the barnacles that cling to the hull of the alternative media boat, shall we say, they post all kinds of rubbish on the net. You know, the driver pulling a pistol out from under his right arm,
yes.
pulls it out with his left hand, then turns around. And it looks really realistic. It really does. But that's not what happened. They should be looking at several things. If you don't mind, I'll toss them out.
Oh, please.
But, well, some of them are sort of, they're not the most, they're not the guns with the most smoke coming out of them, so to speak. But, for example, was Abraham Zapruder using a tripod? All reports are no. Well, I don't know about you, but if I were filming the President of the United States driving down the street right in front of me and I heard rifles going off, I'm not sure I could hold that camera quite that steady.
No, good point.
Number two, everybody, go to your favorite search. You don't even have to open Google or any of that. Just right there in the browser bar where you would type the address for a website, type in these letters and name. J.D. Tippett, T-I-P-P-I-T.
Yes.
And when you see the images come up, tell me who he looks like. And a very interesting guy, I'm going to keep his name private for now, but he's been with the Caravan to Midnight from the beginning as a member. He said, look at the ears. Look at the ears, and you will see. He said, he called the office. He said, John B. is right on the money. He goes, look at the ears. Look at the shape of the ears. That's J.D. Tippit lying on that slab in those so-called death photos of John Kennedy. That is not John Kennedy, because if you'll notice, it doesn't even really, it looks kind of like him. It looks enough like him that you believe it.
Mm-hmm.
But in your head, you're going, well, probably after you've been shot in the head like that, you would probably look a little different. Well, that's because it's not John Kennedy on that slab, in my opinion. That's J.D. Tippit. Because just to let the cat out of the bag, J.D. Tippit is the spitting image of John Kennedy.
Now, wasn't Tippit the one that pulled Oswald over?
He's the one that supposedly accosted Oswald,
yeah.
And Oswald shot him. But why would somebody, there were supposedly, the report is that there were empty pistol cartridge casings on the street. Now, why would a guy who has just been set up as the assassin, let's say that, why would the assassin of a president running away, fleeing the scene, shoot a Dallas cop and then stop long enough to pop the cylinder out of his revolver and empty the cases,
mm-hmm.
so that they would be found in the street, and then what, reload and then continue his exodus from the scene of the crime? That's just stupid. But here's something else, Kay. This is how this speaks to how naive and trusting we all were in those days. You're telling me that at the height of the Cold War, sack bombers overhead 24 hours a day with nuclear bombs in the bomb bay, you let a United States Marine Corps radar specialist, not some knuckle dragger, you know, but a sharp guy who is not an operator, not a technician, a radar specialist. You let him defect to the Soviet Union, which, like, how did he get there? Did he swim across the Murmansk Straits or what? You let him go to the Soviet Union and then come back with a Russian wife. And he's not in chains, he's not in Leavenworth, he's not in jail. You let him come back.
Mm-hmm.
And now you got him on film down there right in New Orleans by the Office of Naval Intelligence, ONI, right there in New Orleans. There's a Navy base there. I don't know, there may still be one, I don't know, but there was then. And now he's on the street and you're getting film of him passing out Fair Play for Cuba leaflets and going across the street over there and voting with black people and just generally making an annoyance of himself. Lee Oswald had already prevented an assassination in Chicago.
Really?
Yeah. This is not generally known. Having met on many occasions, and I'm now, I'm not going to say we're friends because we haven't had a chance to get to know each other that well, but we are certainly very close acquaintances and have total, you know, sympathy. She came on the program last year. And I asked her, I said, that would be Judith the Very Baker, who worked with Mary Sherman, who was assassinated in New Orleans doing cancer research. And there's a wonderful book out, two of them, one by Judith called Me and Lee, and another one, Dr. Mary's Monkey by William T. Hazlitt. And I said, okay, Judith, I'm going to ask you these questions just straight down the barrel, like no holds barred, just no punches pulled, just here they come. And she said, I would prefer that. I said, okay, here's number one. Lee Harvey Oswald, CIA officer, yes or no? And she said, yes.
Ooh.
I said, but no FBI. She goes, them too. He got checks from both of them every week. I saw them.
Oh.
Okay. He told her, they're going to find me dead holding a rifle. They're going to set me up for John Kennedy's assassination. They're going to kill him. And I'm going to be their patsy. And if this woman is making this up, first of all, why would she do this? Well, that's because the New World Order wants her to live in exile. They want to make it really realistic. Well, these people don't. Only the true believers are willing to live, you know, in a let's just say, in a garbage heap. I'm not saying that's where Jesus lives. I'm just saying only the true believers, the true fanatics, are willing to live a life of deprivation in order to support the official line. You know, there's going to be some reason for them to do it. Either it's a threat against their family if they don't, or it's the promise of money, or it's the promise of something. There is no reason for Judith Baker to put out this kind of story.
She'd have nothing to gain.
Absolutely nothing. I mean, not even in furtherance of supporting the official story. Why would she do this? I mean, Kay, it's so frustrating. Now, I'm going to wander around all over the place. You bring me back to center if I get too far off or if I forget, which sometimes I do.
Okay.
And it's because so many of these things, it really is a matrix of all these elements are connected. It's almost like that 6 degrees of separation, which is a theory that anything or any person, you can connect with that through a series of no more than 6 steps. Okay. And that's why all this stuff hooks together like this. You see, I'm off the trail already just because it's just so absolutely wild. But something else. When I ran out of gas, I may have told you this story already, but when I ran out of gas on this Harley Davidson motorcycle I was riding back during the rock and roll radio days, a guy on an almost identical motorcycle pulled over. Only thing that was different was he had the S&S carburetor, and I still had a factory key hen on mine. He said, "What's the matter?" I said, "I ran out of gas." He goes, "I'll go get you some." So he ran up and got me some, and I said, "Dude, you just saved me an amazingly arduous push and walk to get this thing to that gas station up there. So thank you." I said, "If you want to come down to the zoo, I'll give you a tour of the studio if you want to see it. If you don't, the meat and the beer are on me, pal, because you saved me on this one." Well, he came down like either the next day or the day after. And it was right there in downtown Dallas, about probably 350, 400 yards from Dealey Plaza. Call it 500. Easy walking distance, very, very few blocks. And I said, "What do you want to do?" He said, "Well, you know, I'd really like to go over to Dealey Plaza." I said, "You know what? It's right over there, and I've never been over there. Let's go." So we went over there, parked our bikes behind the building, and started looking around. And what I saw was that decorative balustrade that goes across the triple underpass of Commerce, Main, and Elm Street. Elm Street being the one closest to the school book depository, runs right in front of it.
Mm-hmm.
That balustrade goes across the bridge, but then it carried up toward downtown. And it terminated in a 10-foot by 10-foot little, almost like a little patio area where you could set up your lawn chairs and a table. Not lawn chairs, but, you know, little wrought iron chairs or something. Sit there and have a nice tea or something.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing that would have made that difficult was that there was this about a 2.5, maybe 3 foot, it was a big hatch, a square on the floor, open, with no cover on it at all. And there was just a little cutout in the balustrade where you could walk into it. And the first thing I thought was, I can't believe that this thing is open. Somebody could walk around here at night or just not watch what they're doing, just fall right down that thing. And then I started thinking about this deal that had run on Channel 8 television, which was one of my clients in those days, and was for 25 years, and they had run this, this fellow named David Caldwell had put this thing together called the Kennedy Tapes, and it ran between like 3 in the morning and 4, where absolutely nobody was watching, but it was all of the film that had been shot and converted to videotape, transferred to video, that had been taken that day. And this is the shot that we've all seen. It's the Dallas motorcycle cops got his Harley laid over in the street, and he's looking down a storm drain.
That's
Everybody's
right.
Seen it, you know? Well, that storm drain connects to that shaft that I was looking down. There's no doubt about it. Did I go down there? No. But of course it did, because it was right over there. And there were these big U-shaped iron rungs sunk into the wall of the shaft that you would use as a ladder to go down. And I'm dropping kitchen matches down there trying to see how deep it goes. I'm dropping pebbles. I can't even hear them hit the ground. So it must have been a good 25, 30 feet down.
Mm.
And I thought to myself, and then I looked up toward Elm Street's one way, so I just looked toward the oncoming traffic, and it curves, as I'm looking at it, it curves slightly to my left, and then right where John Kennedy got hit, it's coming straight at you. And not only that, but the street was slightly sloped, so that the car was descending as it came toward you. And I'm just looking at this. I'm looking at people sitting in the cars, and I go, you know, if somebody was sitting in the back seat, their head would be clear of the windshield. The windshield would be below the person's head as you were looking at it. And then thinking back on the Zapruder film where it's like, bam, throat shot, and then bam, headshot. Mm-hmm. It's like, pow, pow. And I'm thinking, all you would have to do is just come up with your rifle, bolt-action rifle, already got one up the tube, safety on, it's got a sling on it, put it over your shoulder. Somebody calls you on the little walkie-talkie and says, 150 yards in closing, get ready. I'm going to count you down as soon as he gets to the corner. Well, we know that the car slowed down. We know this. You can. I'm getting excited here. You can see the car slow down to make sure they got him. And they did. And all it was is come up out of that hole, wrap your sling around your arm, get down on those sights, a scope, go bam, rack that bolt, bam. And that is, I've shot all kinds of rifles and stuff over the years, and that's what would happen. You could rack a bolt really quickly and get back on target, and it would have been exactly the amount of time, in my opinion, for you to fire a shot, re-rack a new round into the chamber, get back down on your scope. It might not even have left the scope. Might have just held it steady. Just boom, rack the bolt, steady, boom, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And that's what happened. Then away they go. Oh, let's get to Parkland. Let's go right away. Well, then all the guys that were like, no, stay back. Just stay out of there. When I cannot remember who the man was or is. He may still be alive. Who knows? It wasn't a district attorney. Maybe it was an assistant district attorney, but I can't remember. He indicated that the guy that he saw, he put his finger up to his forehead where he'd been hit in the forehead. There are rumors. I do not know if this is true or not, but many people have said that there's a bullet hole that came through the top of the windshield. Okay. Maybe, maybe not. But one thing's for sure, when you shoot someone with a rifle, your head doesn't go toward the rifle.
No.
That just doesn't happen. And, you know, they tried to play that card for years. And then I think it was 60 Minutes. It might not have been 60 Minutes, but I'm thinking that it was. Do you recall seeing that thing where they had the all of the so-called file films of Dealey Plaza, you know, that were just routine FBI file films?
Mm-hmm. I didn't see that.
Well, this needs to be seen again, because I can remember maybe it was Morley Safer or one of them. I think it was. Saying, now, is this somebody in a window here, or is this someone in a window? Well, the fact is that you can see guys in, remember the old IRS record label that had the guy with the sunglasses and the black suit with the white shirt and the black tie and the sunglasses on and all that? Well, that's what these guys looked like. They were next to, keep in mind, folks, that the shot didn't come from the very top floor. It was the second of the top floor on the corner. Well, there's guys above. There's guys below. There's guys next to the window. You can see this. You can see people standing there. This is not some optical illusion. They aren't like sharp, like they're standing on, hey, taking a family photograph, but you can see that there are people there.
Right.
And the next question is, so you're telling me that they just decided to just film the entire parade route? Where exactly were all of the cameramen? And I mean, it's just stupid. But the thing is that we believed it because we screwed up. And we trusted the government, and we trusted the news media. And the news media was completely complicit, in my opinion,
mm-hmm.
in keeping this thing concealed for as long as they have.
Well, people wanted to believe it. They did not want to think that their government could be so corrupt as to destroy their own government, you know, the president.
Well, yeah. And the thing is, people go, why is the Kennedy assassination? It was over 50 years ago. I mean, who cares? It's like, do you not understand what it means if it can be proved that our own government arranged for the execution of a president? Do you really not understand what that means? It doesn't mean that, oh, well, something terribly wrong happens. Like, yeah. But that was just the beginning of the terrible wrong
mm-hmm.
that has proceeded from that day. Barely 6 months later, Lyndon Johnson commits us to Vietnam.
Yes.
And we were there from April 64 until 1975 and made billions of dollars for the military-industrial complex. Everybody. See, when you invent a car, you're not just selling cars. That's not only the money. It's the roads, it's the concrete, the asphalt, the machines to do that, the gas stations, the signs for the gas station, the gas pumps, the rubber for the hoses, the rubber and the wiring and the light bulbs and the carpet and the leather or the vinyl or the chrome. It's all of this stuff goes into making a car. It's not just one thing, you know? Sure. It's not just like, oh, a car. Oh, it just magically appears. And so when you talk about the military-industrial complex, don't get caught on... I know you're not, Kay. I'm just
oh, I know.
People who haven't thought about it this way. I'm not picking on you, Kay. When you hear these terms, don't just let them strike you as something that's a familiar term to you. Contemplate them. Contemplate the meaning. What do they mean, military-industrial complex? Well, what does complex mean? It means there's a lot of components, a lot. And so when we go, well, you know, it wasn't just bombs. It was everything that goes into a war effort, from the web gear to the uniforms, to the deodorant, the soaps, the tooth powder, the toothbrushes, the bayonet holders, the rifles, the magazines, the springs, the floor plates, the ammunition, the paint. It's endless. And it was a lot of money. What in the world were we doing involving ourselves for 11 years with all of those losses over Vietnam? Like Vietnam was some strategic location? Oh, no. Well, Lyndon Johnson thought if we didn't go there, people would perceive him as being soft on communism.
Mm-hmm. And it was never called
really?
A war. That was the thing. It was a military action, but they never declared it as a war.
Mm-hmm. That's what kept them legal. Same thing with the Korean War. What was the point of going in there? That actually had more validity than going into Vietnam, because at least, you know, they're trying to destroy the South, and the South, as we know, is a wonderful place. We do a lot of business with them now. But then again, so is Vietnam. So is somebody going to tell me that the reason all those lives were sacrificed on both sides, and of course 90% of the casualties were civilians, always are in every war, we're going to say that that's so we could make Vietnam a nice place to do business, where now we can buy all kinds of stuff? You look on the label and see the manufacturer, and it was it's Vietnam. Is that what that was all about? I don't think so. I think it was about the money that they made while the conflict was happening.
And it never would have happened if Kennedy had not been assassinated.
You know, he wasn't going to send anybody over there. He told them no, but they wanted the war.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted the war. And you know, the thing is that if we allow ourselves to be distracted by all these things that are put out there for us to be distracted, unless they bring them to market, unless they're approved, well, we can't buy them. They're not available. So all these things are made to be bought. They are distraction. And then you can buy, okay, they're distracted. Now, let's work on the education system a little bit. Let's work on the family a little bit. And we definitely need to get rid of Christianity. Why? Because communism wants your obedience to be not to your family, not to the Lord, to the state. And people just can't imagine that something that monstrous in concept could actually be true. But folks, it is true.
Mm-hmm.
Look at these moron idiot Muslims. I'm not pulling you into my jackpot. That comment is on me, Kay. There's a deal in express.co.uk that shows that all these idiots celebrating the birth, I think it was the birth or the death, one or the other, of Mohammed's grandson, and they're cutting themselves on the head with machetes and sharp objects and so forth to where they're literally, it looks like some... haunted house on Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
They're drenched in blood. I mean, it's up now.
It's a bloodbath.
Anybody can look at it and see. It's a bloodbath, a real one. And you're going, now, what would motivate somebody to do something like this? Well, it's absolute, unrestrained religious fervor. And all these idiots will come out there and they'll say, well, they worship the same God we do. No, they don't.
No.
No, they don't. They worship Allah, and he is not the God of Abraham. and Charles Levaillant, who was, part of the French contingency that was involved in one of the Crusades. Oh, he made this observation. These people worship the same God. Well, no, they don't. So you got it wrong, Charles. It's simply not true. And they have, Islam has borrowed little components that they can use from Christianity and even Judaism. But now, you can't pray to the God of Abraham in their presence. They threw, I don't know how many people overboard when they were making their exodus to Europe out of what we call the Middle East.
That's right.
So, why are we embracing this? I mean, are these people so insane that they really want to destabilize the entirety of Western civilization by bringing all these people in who are much more committed to their cause than we are to ours, it would appear? I don't see any Christians crucifying Muslims, blowing up mosques. I don't see any of that. I've never heard a Christian say, well, those Muslim women over there, they're just non-believers, so, God will be pleased with us if we rape them. It's insane.
It is.
It's absolute insanity. And in fact, a theologian who was on our program said, John, he's from South Africa, so I'll try to duplicate his accent. He said, John, I'm about to say something that's very politically incorrect. I said, go right on ahead, sir. He said, I believe that Islam is Satan's masterpiece. And I told him, I entirely agree, and I do. So, why? First it was Vietnam. First it was Korea. Okay, fine. Got a bunch of people killed over there. And then a few short years later, here we are again, about, 11 years later? I think it was over with in 53. In 64, here we are again. Gulf of Tonkin has been revealed to be a complete fraud. And rumor has it, and maybe a little bit more than rumor, that Jim Morrison of The Doors, the lead singer for The Doors, his father was not only a Navy admiral, he was the Navy admiral that was one of the primary players in the Gulf of Tonkin incident.
I've heard that.
An incident which did not occur. I mean, it's insane. It really is. So when you go up against people like this, you can't do it by yourself. But now there are so many people that they're scrambling. They are really trying to cover their backs, and they're finding it increasingly more difficult. So what do you do when you want to cover your back when the people are about to turn on you? Well, you create an international incident. Hopefully it'll lead to a war, and that'll distract them and keep them off of you, and they'll forget, because people do have short memories, which is why I have pledged that I will continue to talk about John Kennedy until the rats who arranged for his assassination are found out. And then hopefully they may all have departed this life, but at least we can make a wall and etch their names deeply into it so that those names can be remembered for generations in shame.
That's so important, because they don't have... What gives them the right to get away with that? What gives them the right to take someone else's life? And to me, it was the beginning of the destruction of America.
Well, it's like Adolf Hitler said, unbelievable how a people must be betrayed in order to rule them.
Mm.
So that's all it is. It's a betrayal of everything. It's a betrayal of everything that we held dear. And as long as we can stay in the darkness of ignorance, then okay, they're safe and the operation doesn't skip a beat.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want the truth, the question is, do you really want to know? And if you say no, then okay. But if you do, be prepared to be upset, because the truth, sometimes it will strike you like steel.
And you can't forget, you cannot unlearn the truth.
Mm-mm.
It doesn't just go away.
No, once knowledge becomes wisdom, you better not go back to your former ways, because there will be blowback for that.
Mm-hmm. Well, John Kennedy was an extremely intelligent man. He wasn't a man of, I believe, high morality. But he was very intelligent. He knew the workings of the government. And I've always been shocked that he never saw some of the writing on the wall before his assassination, because there were things that stood out. One of them is the fact that his car was different than the other cars, so that it could be easily spotted.
You bet. Yeah, notice that the portrait of him, he appears to be leaning against the wall and looking down. Oh, I'm sure that's a complete accident. I'm sure there's no real, you know, these freaks like symbols.
Mm-hmm.
They like symbols. They like phoenixes. By the way, that's not an eagle on the back of the $1 bill. That's a phoenix. And, you know, there are 13 stars in that little thing that looks kind of like a Star of David. Really does. Well, there's 13 stars in that. There are 13 leaves on the olive branch. Maybe it's mistletoe, but I think it's supposed to be an olive branch. And there are 13 arrowheads on the in the arrow that's the bunch of arrows there that's held in the other talon of the phoenix.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the little owl, tiny, tiny little owl on the front of the $1 bill, upper right in the curved part of the frame around the number one. You have to look very, very closely, but if you look very, very closely, you'll see a little owl sitting in there. It's a little version of the big one that they dance around out at Bohemian Grove. And, you know, what's this eyeball in the triangle floating above the rest of the pyramid, the capstone there? I mean, well, what's up with that? These people are freaks, and they're very much into specific dates and specific symbols to aid them. I mean, in a conversation with a couple of biogeometry specialists, Doctors Ibrahim Karim and Pierpaolo... Dr. Alberghini, yeah, Dr. Alberghini, Pierpaolo Alberghini, and Dr. Ibrahim Karim, an Italian and an Egyptian. When you talk to them, you know, I ask them, is the presence of a certain geometric shape in your life where you can see it and be around it, is it an influence on your life? And it was a resounding yes. And the ancients knew that as well. That's why they have so much of that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So what you're dealing with in many cases here, I'm not going to say all of them, but certainly some of them, these are people who, oh, they very much believe in God. They've just consciously chosen to not serve Him. Meaning, it's not that they've consciously chosen not to serve Him. They've consciously chosen to not serve Him.
Like Lucifer. He knows God and knows all about Him, but he chooses not to serve Him.
Yeah, some of these people have decided to go against Him. I mean, they keep popping off. Some of these people in the higher scientific echelons are like, we can make ourselves as gods. Well, go to your scripture, and it says right there, people are going to try and do it. And they're going to be successful on some level, too. People are going to seek death, and it will flee from them. Well, how are you going to kill yourself if your brain is loaded up onto a hard drive somewhere and they can stick it into any meat puppet that they happen to come up with to for your brain to inhabit? They can make your memories appear and disappear. The super soldier, DARPA, has worked out this chip that turns your thoughts instantly into actions. And so if you have a chip and then there's another chip that can record your memories... Well, if they can record your memories, they can insert your memories, just as in the same way that every speaker is also a microphone. All you have to do is hook the speaker up to the input instead of the output and talk into it and plug your headphones into the amp, and sure enough, it's a microphone.
Mm-hmm.
And so if it can receive, it can also transmit. Now, if you listen closely, you'll hear the national anthem playing in the background.
Do you think there was any type of programming that Oswald may have went through? I mean, even though he was not the trigger man, do you think that there was any manipulation that helped to basically get him to do what they wanted him to do?
You know, there's no way for me to know that. I can't even really speak to that, but I can say this, that we had on the program today a man who, I can't call his last name because it's Polish, it's a Ryszlak,
mm-hmm.
Yep, Ron Ryszlak, and he worked with a high-ranking member of the old Romanian secret police who defected to this country back in the late 70s. And some of the work that he was involved with, and certainly some of the work that this, I can't call this man's name, I'll pull it up here in a second off the hard drive of my head, talked about how, you know, the Soviets wanted to assassinate a number of people, including Mao Zedong, mm-hmm. and numerous others, and also John Kennedy. But at the last minute, they changed their minds on assassinating Kennedy, but Lee Oswald could not be controlled. It's like, Lee Oswald could have been controlled real easy. They could have whacked him out the moment that he came back to the United States after, as a Marine, defecting to the Soviet Union. None of this makes any sense. So, do I think he was programmed? I don't have any evidence to suggest that he was. Trained and conditioned, yes. Programmed, no. And I think that may be one of, maybe they tried to program him and it failed. I mean, who knows? Maybe Lee Oswald was, they tried to program him to kill the president in Chicago, but he broke his programming.
Oh.
And maybe that's why they decided to go, now, Lee, you did real good protecting the president. So you know what? We're going to put you in a strategic position in Dallas because you do good work. I mean, you're all right. You're solid. Well, he met with two other guys. We had a fellow on the program one time who he and his girlfriend were in downtown Dallas. They saw Lee Oswald and two other guys meet something like 2 weeks before the assassination. It was like the Southland Club or something that they met at. So
yeah, I was reading about that.
Mm-hmm. So who were these guys? And then let's look at Jack Ruby. Jack Ruby goes to jail after shooting Lee Oswald. And who's the first guy to come visit him in jail? A fellow named Joe Campisi. Joe Campisi had this restaurant called Campisi's Egyptian, even though it was a pizza place. They just liked the sign. It was cool. So I never really got it until I heard the story many years later. I said, Egyptian? There's no Egyptian food here. It's all Italian. What is this? It's like, well, they liked the sign, so Joe just left it. Well, they were, in my opinion, money launderers, you know, meaning you just show on your books that you sold a lot more pizza than you really did, you know?
Right.
But look, Dallas was a crooked town in those days. Even the creation of Dallas was done on the sly. It's one of those almost a Jekyll Island deal where they decided to create the Federal Reserve on, you know, Christmas or whatever. And they're always doing stuff like that. This ridiculous thing to extend the debt ceiling by $50 billion and then $30 billion more on top of that all the way through Obama's term. That was being kicked around last night real late.
Mm-hmm.
Well, no, you know, so to speak. It would have been on, the 27th of October. So these guys never stop. And if you can't get a joint through the airport without getting caught, but you can get a metric ton of heroin through the airport, I'm thinking probably the way that you do that is by paying guys off, and they would be your inside help. So that's how things ran back then. If you needed to do something, you had an operation going that was a criminal operation, you're going to have to pay off the cops.
Right.
You're probably going to have to pay off the FBI. You're going to have to do them some favors. You're going to have to rat somebody else out on the sly so you didn't get caught. But you're going to have to help them or you're going to wind up in the penitentiary,
mm-hmm.
period. Nobody wants to go to the penitentiary. So that's the way it ran down here. But isn't it interesting that a low-level mafia guy, they used to call Dallas Little Chicago. Let's put it that way. Now, that's a fact.
Right.
And there was a place on McKinney Avenue called the Dixie House. And they took this off the menus before it finally changed locations. And it's still in operation, but it's actually over in East Dallas now. It's a different, you know, obviously it's a different building and all. But that was actually one of Jack Ruby's clubs. And they had it on the back of the menu what the history of the building was. Well, after a while, they took that off their menus because it just it piqued people's interest and they started asking questions and they didn't want any questions. It's like the last 30 years have just sped by so quickly. And you see that many of these landmarks and many of these reminders of that that day in Dealey Plaza have been erased. Going back to that patio deal that was right there by the school book depository,
mm-hmm.
Not very many years later, let's see, that would have been about 81, I think. Yeah, probably 81. 4 or 5 years later, and I've been over there since, you know, looking around. Yeah, it's still there. And I thought, you know, I should get a picture of that. Well, as my father said, if you don't take a picture, you won't have one. And I really messed up on that big time because I did not take a picture. But when I saw the little tiny article in the Dallas Morning News that Oliver Stone was coming to make a movie about the assassination of John Kennedy, I thought, you know what, I better get over there and get a picture of this. So I stalled for about another 2 weeks, and when I got there, you know what I found? It was gone. It was asphalted over, completely erased, as if it were never there.
Surprise, surprise.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. They didn't want Oliver Stone to find it.
No, they did not, because, I mean, that, I'm telling you, that was the sniper's nest.
Well, you know, I've heard...
I would.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. No, you go ahead, please.
I've heard a lot of people talk about Dealey Plaza that when you see it on television, it looks like it's fairly good size. But when you actually get there, it's not a very big place. So
no, it's not.
They wouldn't have had to travel far to go under that tunnel to come out somewhere else and be out of the loop.
No, not at all, because, you know, the river bottoms are very close by, and... Oh, there's all sorts of stuff underground in Dallas. There are huge storm drains that have been, abandoned, and they've decided to route the water elsewhere and through, because, I mean, that's protecting an investment. You know, once you've built the thing, well, how are we going to employ all these construction workers? Well, simple. We just come up with another project.
Mm-hmm.
But there's all kinds of stuff underground in Dallas, and that storm drain system was barely adequate. Because there have been occasions when that entire area, like, would go underwater sometimes if you got a really, really serious, just one of those once every few years super heavy rains.
Right.
It would flood down there, and it would overwhelm that system. So I'm sure that's why they, you know, regraded the road, changed the angle on it. I'm sure they did a bunch of stuff underground, but the city has just exploded over the last 30 years with all kinds of development and rebuilding this and rerouting that to where you can barely recognize it.
Now, when you went back and you found that was covered over, did you go to the other end where the police officer was photographed looking down into the manhole? Was it covered also?
No. That manhole, there's a manhole cover on top of the little concrete structure that is the storm drain. However, it is welded shut.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, and it was not welded shut for a long time. And I always thought, you know, I just didn't do it, Kay. I just didn't do it, which is why I'm telling you, look, I'm one of you, people. Whoever's listening to this broadcast, I'm one of you. I could have, but I didn't. And now I have regrets about it. Because if I'd taken a picture of that, and actually gone down that thing and checked it out, that might be very valuable now. But you think things aren't going to change. You think they're going to stay the same. That's what we want. We want to stay the same, but things don't stay the same. They change. People pass away. They forget. Somebody writes a letter, and it winds up over here. I just need to get rid of all this junk, and you've just thrown away a vital piece of history, and you didn't even know it, or you didn't care, or you thought, this is more like Kennedy stuff. I'll just throw it away. So don't do that. You know, just don't. If you need a picture of something, take it or you won't have it. Because I could have taken pictures, but I didn't. And this I consider to be a personal failure because I had no idea, of course, in those days that I would be doing what I'm doing today. But I sensed that I should take a picture of it, but I didn't. So now all it is breath. You know, it's just words that I can't prove. You know,
hindsight 2020.
Absolutely. 2015, maybe.
I wanted to ask you, does the carousel, I think it's called the Carousel Club, does that still exist down there? Because not John Kennedy, but Lyndon Johnson had an affair with a woman, and her name was Madeline, I'm drawing a blank. Madeline Brown?
I know who you mean.
Okay. Now, she said that she had seen Jack Ruby and Oswald meet there one day. So I'm just curious, is that one of those locations, too, that they've had to, like, calm things down so they're not asked so many questions and bombarded?
You know, I can find out pretty quickly. I'll take a look while we're talking here. There was another club that was of some note also called the It'll Do Club. And I understand that Ruby had some affiliation with that, although I'm not entirely sure what it was. But that's where all the action was happening, was at these various clubs, and it still is today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's, let me see, the Carousel Club. I'll just take a peek real quick. Let's see what we got.
Okay.
Oh, yes. Former Dallas stripper recalls Jack Ruby's club 50 years later. That's from October 5, 2013.
So Jack Ruby owned
it? Let's see about that. This is Dallas News. So that's Dallas Morning News, undoubtedly, from a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll just see if anything comes up.
I didn't find that on my research. That would be interesting.
You know, one time I saw this, I can't remember what show it was, but this, you know, this beautiful woman who's distraught and distressed, a damsel in distress, comes into this private eye's office, right?
Mm-hmm.
And she's got to find this guy. And she says, I'll pay whatever. He goes, well, I'm $100 an hour or whatever it was, or $250, something. So she says, well, I need to find, you know, so-and-so and so-and-so. So he picks up the phone book and he opens it and he goes, okay, and he wrote the address down. He said, here you go, and it's $250, please. And the point is, all you have to do is just go look.
Right.
You know? Hear how Ruby was always a fidget at the Carousel, wanting everything just right, not letting patrons cause trouble or his MCs tell vulgar jokes. So, yes, that was his club. Let's see. Hear how Ruby was always trying to stay in shape, how he didn't smoke, occasionally drank a glass of wine off and swam, wearing a little blue cap at the Oak Cliff apartment complex where he lived in 1963. Well, isn't that interesting that Lee Oswald lived on Beckley Avenue, which is in Oak Cliff, just south of Interstate 30. There's an exit for Beckley over there.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And then, yeah. Oh, yeah, and then you've got Myers briefly lived near Ruby at those Oak Cliff apartments, the long-gone Marsala Place at 223 South Ewing Avenue. So Ewing Avenue is right over there, too. Oak Cliff was really quite a cool place. It still is. It's like time stopped about 1935 or something over there. They're trying to gentrify it now, which is a shame, because when you drive through there, you see all these great old houses. And, you know, a lot of them are modest, but a lot of them are actually quite nice. And, but they're erasing everything as fast as they can. Let's see if Jack Ruby, let's just put in Jack Ruby, whose real name is Rubenstein, as everybody probably knows, and the It'll Do Club. Let's see if he had an affiliation with that. That's funny. It it doesn't say anything yet about... no, the Carousel Club keeps coming up over and over again. But I'm pretty sure that it was one of his places. I remember seeing a picture... some gal kind of showing off her figure to him.
You know,
I guess he was auditioning waitresses or something, but it was at the It'll Do Club. So certainly he was a, Jack Ruby was a connected guy. I'm pretty sure that there was no club in Dallas that he didn't have access to.
I've noticed through the years that you're able to find less and less in the searches, because even with businesses closing down, like you said, they're also removing parts from the search engines and information so you can't look it up.
Well, that's the thing. When the books are gone and the newspapers are gone and you have nothing but a computer screen to look at, then if they delete it, then it's gone and that's it and you're stuck,
mm-hmm.
Which is why they want to run absolutely everything over the Internet.
I miss the hard copy. I really do with the books. How close is Austin to Dallas?
180 miles.
Because doing the research... I'd found where they'd had the party the night before Kennedy's assassination, and Johnson had told the woman he was having an affair with, Madeline Brown, that he wasn't going to have to worry anymore, that Kennedy wasn't going to embarrass him. But they also had the night of the assassination a celebration and had LBJ, Nixon, Jack Ruby, and I've even read different articles where possibly even Bush was there.
Yeah, former President George H.W. Bush, the man who couldn't remember where he was on November 22nd, 63.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody else in the world can remember where they were, but he can't.
That's pretty pathetic. I mean...
But they say that even Richard Nixon was down here. I mean, it appears to have been some sort of a cult deal with lots and lots and lots of witnesses and people who were interested parties that had all come down here to view the elimination of the president. I mean, it's just sick.
It's like he was sacrificed.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, without a doubt. Because when Lyndon Johnson came in, everything changed.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Kennedy was opening up a dialogue with the Soviet Union. He and Khrushchev were getting along. And then that whole thing with the Cuban Missile Crisis came up, and Kennedy was like, I can't back down off this, Nikki. I can't do it. So, there, you know, it's so deliciously complicated. It really is. Khrushchev goes, okay. He sent a message to Kennedy that said, we should not tug too hard on the rope into which we have tied this knot. And Khrushchev went on summer vacation, and when he came back, it was like his desk was emptied out, and all his phone numbers had been changed, and he was just out. That was all of it. After all that beating a shoe on the table at the UN, we will bury you and all that stuff.
Right.
All of that was over with. There's a story, and I don't know if it really happened or not, but the story is that when Stalin was dying, he called Khrushchev in to see him, and he handed him two envelopes marked 1 and 2. And he said, if you get into trouble, open envelope number 1. If you get into trouble again, open up envelope number 2. So something happened, and I don't remember what it was, but the first one was... It had something to do with Europe and the wall and all this grief over that. So Khrushchev went and opened up the first envelope, and it said, blame it all on me. And then when the Cuban Missile Crisis came up, so he did. He did blame it all on Joe Stalin, and it blew over. So
interesting.
The Cuban Missile Crisis came up, and he went to envelope number 2, and he opened it, and the words that were written on the paper said, make out 2 envelopes.
Oh.
I suspect that's a true story, because you only get one chance to mess up on a spectacular level, and you're out.
Mm-hmm.
After that, you can't do it twice. And that goes back to Adolf Hitler. Adolf Hitler wrote in Mein Kampf that any politician who messes up should never be allowed in politics ever again, because he may make another mistake.
True.
So, you know, Kay, people need to get a map. A really nice, doesn't have to be an expensive map, but just a nicely detailed, easy to read map. And look at these places in the world where all this stuff is happening, and look how close they are to other places that you think you're familiar with, but you don't carry in your head where they really are.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for example, you can walk from Syria to Europe. No problem. Those people on the boats, it's not like going from Boston Harbor to England or something over the Atlantic Ocean. You've got the shoreline in sight the whole time. It's nothing.
Yeah.
And when you go, oh, now wait a minute. It's like, yeah, the Middle East is right over there. Most people don't even know that the Middle East is in Africa.
That's
they don't
true.
Know what sub-Saharan Africa means. It means underneath the space, the land underneath the Sahara Desert. They don't know that. And our education system is being dumbed down to the point where, as time goes by, we will know less and less and less and less. And as you said, stuff will start disappearing from the net, and it's gone.
Yeah, if they dumb down people enough, they're going to believe anything. They become part of a mass robotic system.
Absolutely. And in fact, Adolf Hitler had had some things to say about addressing the masses. If you speak reasonably to an individual, and even though you're correct, and you put forth your arguments, he won't listen to you. 9 times out of 10, he won't listen to you. I'm paraphrasing Adolf a little bit here.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, but if you get everybody together Well, I'm paraphrasing him even more heavily. What he was saying was, you get this mob mentality, you get the mass mentality. The mass mentality is different from the individual mentality. If you can get them all together, before long, exactly what happened will happen, which is there will be guys and women, you know, with their hands over their faces, you know, weeping, saying, he really does understand me. He understands what's happening in my life. He really does. But that won't happen. That's not as easy to do when you're coming into individual people's homes over a TV set. But it really happens when you have a big rally. That's why those rallies were so successful. That's how he was able to get everybody on the same page.
Mm-hmm.
Once you become that Borg and the leader up there speaks to the Borg, then the whole Borg gets it. And when they leave that rally with a remembrance etched into them of how it felt when they heard him speak. And subconsciously, they will remember those things in their hearts and minds that speaker touched. And that's difficult now. So they've decided to do it a different way. Instead of holding big rallies and so forth, they're doing it with chemicals, they're doing it with radiation, they're doing it with electromagnetic radiation, they're doing it with all kinds of things.
Right, sound waves.
Oh, Lord, and people just don't understand how far science has advanced. This stuff is probably, I used to say 30 years ahead of what we think is current technology. Somebody else said, really, it's more like 40. I think I said 20, and they said 30, and then I recently heard 40. Now I'm going all the way to 50,
mm-hmm.
because this science fiction stuff, this is science fact, but they're not going to tell us about it. Folks, remember, back in the World War II days, when we got to watch, in the 60s and 70s, when we were watching World War II movies, and then along comes Saving Private Ryan, and we see, wow, look at that Tiger tank, or wow, look at that cool Tommy gun, or look at this, or look at that. Many of those weapons were not shown to the American public, and they weren't, because it was the best they had at the time. You know, we talk about nuclear weapons now like it's no big deal. You can even see pictures of them. Oh, you mean those black ones? It's like, yeah, that's them.
Mm.
Like, oh, cool, yeah. I've seen a picture of a fat man and little boy, the ones that were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But the thing is they're not showing us now what they have. By the time we see it, it's been deployed for a long time. For example, you know, a really fast firing machine gun, you always see the German soldiers lying next to it, and one of them's feeding in the belt, and the other one's operating the gun, and it's just spewing out
yeah.
deer rifle cartridges at an amazing rate. Well, that's called the MG-34. And that thing fired at an unbelievable rate. The cycle rate was over 1,000 rounds per minute. I can't remember if it was 1,200 or 1,600, but I think it was like 1,600. It just threw deer rifle lead out there like you wouldn't believe. 8mm Mauser is what it was chambered in, and that's bigger around and every bit as good as .30-06. Well, Allied forces managed to capture one of those things, and they took it to the Savage Arms Company. I want to say Savage was in... I think Savage was in Utica, New York, if I'm not mistaken. And they took it to the engineers at Savage, and the engineers said, this thing is sweet. Unfortunately for us, it is so perfectly designed. It would be astronomically expensive to try and put a gun like this into production. We frankly can't do it. So we went with John Browning's designs, which... John Moses Browning was an absolute genius. Everything from the .45 automatic to the 9mm high power to all those machine guns you see, the water-cooled ones, the 50-caliber double-handle thing,
mm-hmm.
the little one you see the guys lying on the ground with a single pistol grip from the World War II days with the slots in the barrel for cooling. That's all John Browning stuff. So we went with that. But the point is that those guys were so consumed with engineering perfection that they created a gun that we could not duplicate, and it was touted as a wonder weapon, and it was devastating, just outrageously devastating. And but they didn't want the American public knowing about these wonder weapons like that fast firing machine gun, or it would spook the citizenry, and they'd be afraid to take them on.
Hmm.
I mean, these guys were into nuclear fission. They came within a hair's breadth of getting a nuclear weapon. They most assuredly would use it.
That's a scary
thought. First cruise missile, Germans. First intercontinental ballistic missile, Germans. first jet deployed in combat, Germans. It's endless.
Mm-hmm.
They were into time travel and all kinds of stuff, but they were also mixed up real heavily in the occult.
Yeah.
And it appears, according to Harry Cooper with Shark Hunters, he's got photographs and everything. Hitler didn't die in that bunker. He didn't commit suicide. And let me just segue, because I'm getting to a point here. It's not just talking about Nazis and stuff. I got a book one time at the antique mall. It used to be right over by Love Field. It's gone now because they had a roof problem. But I found this book, Martin Bormann, Nazi in Exile. And Paul Manning was, of course, a war correspondent. He was one of Cronkite's contemporaries because he's a war correspondent, too. And he asserted that Martin Bormann did not die during some tank battle outside of Berlin, but that Mueller, the SS chief, got everybody out. He got they got the engineers out. They got the scientists out. They got the production floor managers, because even they were expert businessmen. They got them all out. And you had your choice. You could go to South America, or you could go to the Middle East, where the what? Muslim Brotherhood was waiting to help you out, and they did. Okay?
Oh, wow.
Martin Bormann went to South America, set up his little headquarters down there. He's always on the move, but he had it going on. His son's probably still down there. And I spoke with someone, I wish I could remember who it was, but we got 401 programs now, and it'd be very difficult to go back and find which one it was. But by the way, folks, 401 programs as of today.
Okay.
Or is this 402?
Congratulations.
There's more than that. Yeah, it's a bunch of them. But anyway, Paul Manning actually went down to South America to meet with Martin Bormann, who was the corporate brains. He was the financial brains of the Third Reich. Martin Bormann. But at the last minute, Bormann's people decided this was not a good idea, and it didn't happen. But the man told me, Paul Manning did, however, meet Eva Braun. And then Harry Cooper, Shark Hunter, said, oh, Eva Braun and Adolf Hitler, they just decided to just let it go. And Hitler lived out the rest of his life in a nice little place, extraordinarily quiet place, out in the country, down in South America. They just decided to let him get away. But they got rid of everybody else. And at the gymnasium at Nuremberg, they just took them one at a time. Every 10 minutes, they hanged another one. Von Ribbentrop, all of them. Goering committed suicide. Goebbels committed suicide. Speer wound up in Spandau for a while. Let's see, who's the guy? The guy with a big broad jaw, who was the commander of the army. I can't remember. He's the one that bailed out over Scotland trying to arrange a meeting with Winston Churchill to call an end to the war. But they didn't want an end to the war.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted it to go forward. It's just weird, Kay. It's almost as though Satan himself has laid all of these steps out to be followed, because it seems absolutely impossible to me for anyone to have this kind of planning capability. How could they plan such a thing? But it appears that these things have been planned for a long, long time. And to finish, and I will, they brought the Nazis over here, Operation Paperclip. Oh, they denied it for years.
Yeah.
But eventually it was proven that they did, in fact, bring them over here. Von Braun came over to head up our rocket program. The F-86 Sabre jet, the silver one with the open mouth on the front of it, little single-seat fighter used in Korea.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a Messerschmitt design. And the MiG that it was shooting at, flown by the, with the red stars on it, that was Kurt Tank of Fuck Wolf. That was his design. So it was like, it's always been, I mean, ever since the end of World War II, this whole Cold War deal, it's always been our German scientists against their German scientists. They picked out Hugo Junkers, the Junkers Ju-87 Stuka dive bombers who made all this great stuff.
Right.
They picked up his factory and everybody in his crew and took him over to Mother Russia. That's why all that stuff looks like a Junkers design, because it is. So it's endless. These Nazis have never gone away. Prescott Bush, granddad, he was called the Nazi banker. They closed his bank.
Right.
It's nuts. Anyway, I'm getting all jacked up here. Sorry.
Oh, you're fine. I mean, you're saying things, and my mind is going in the same directions. I mean, it's just like with how deep everything runs. And recently it's been stated that Barbara Bush, that her father or grandfather was Aleister Crowley.
It wouldn't surprise me.
And the tentacles just go so deep, and this is something that I couldn't understand. And I'd had Doc Marquis, he's a friend of mine, and we were talking. I said, how do they do it? They go so far back in time, and they move forward, and it's like they don't miss a beat. The plan just continues to roll without any hesitation, and it just picks up where one person leaves off. And he said they believe in reincarnation. The people with the Illuminati and I'm trying to think what else, but that is how they figure that they can make their plan work.
Yeah, it's interesting. If you go on the net and look, it's like, was Aleister Crowley Barbara Bush's father? George W. Bush, Barbara Bush, and Aleister Crowley. Barbara Bush, daughter of Aleister Crowley on YouTube. But there's so much rubbish out there, you know, on YouTube that you just don't know.
That's it. I mean, I did some research, but I wasn't able to completely vet the story. So that's why I say allegedly, but they sure look a lot alike.
Yeah, they do. Now it says, this is listed 10 through 1. There are too many myths about Aleister Crowley to list them all or to attempt to prove them false. This is from ac2012.com. Myth, Aleister Crowley advocated pedophilia. Myth, Aleister Crowley died alone in poverty. Aleister Crowley advocated rape. That's supposed to be a myth, too. He was a drug addict and a failure. That's number 6 of the myths. Number 5 is he worked for the Nazis. That's also a myth. It says here, at least. Aleister Crowley sacrificed male children. That's supposed to be a myth. He was the wickedest man in the world. That's number 3. Number 2 is Aleister Crowley was the father of Barbara Bush. And number 1, there's nothing magical about a shark eating a sea lion. So, I understand a shark will eat anything. I think they've even found tires in them before. So, yeah, that's not much of a stretch.
License plates and everything else. And, you know, with Hitler, too, you saying how he had went to South America, some research I did for another broadcast, one that I was on, Paratruth Radio, that when Hitler supposedly, him and Eva Braun died, that they killed themselves, when it got to the end, that they and 1,000 other people just mysteriously disappeared. And that goes along with what you're saying, that how they were killing them and they escaped and they found a way to get out. But it's documented, but they really don't tell you much about how they did it.
Yeah. Now, who comes to mind as being one of the more suspicious ones, more suspicious deaths to you?
What, as far as prominent people?
Yeah.
I would say Hitler. It's pretty strange.
Yeah, they covered him. You know, it's just so odd. I mean, and the Japanese. I mean, but you can repeat these things, you can say them, but you have to be very careful to qualify it with, this cannot be easily proved.
Mm-hmm.
But supposedly the Japanese were conducting all kinds of, you know, they had sound guns and ray guns and all kinds of stuff they were working on, right? But apparently they walked. You notice they didn't go through a Nuremberg-style trial like the Germans did. If they were, because not very many people could read Japanese, and there was just a monstrous amount of data. But they had done all these experiments on human beings. And, of course, they would list them in their notes as a monkey, but it wasn't a monkey. It was a person.
Mm-hmm.
And the Allies just told them, listen, you turn over all this information, and you interpret it for us accurately, and we will let you walk on what you've done. But if we get the idea that you're not giving us absolutely every detail accurately contained in these notes, the deal's off, and you'll probably be executed. And they went for the deal. So, making people disappear is the stock and trade of governments. I mean, look what happened to Breitbart. And isn't it curious that Breitbart and Hastings and Clancy, all those guys are gone in a short period of time?
Yeah.
Philip Marshall, all these people. It's like, well, they. I mean, do I think that Breitbart got rubbed out? I don't know. But I don't know what he was doing. The story is he was at a bar in L.A. Well, what are you doing at a bar in L.A.? You're about to drop a big, massive bombshell about Obama, and you're at a bar in L.A. Really?
Right.
I mean, how stupid is that?
He shouldn't have been out. I mean, he'd been talking with Alex Jones, and I believe it was ManCal, where he was going to release that important information, and Alex was really surprised that he wasn't one of the targets, too, because he knew what was going to be released. But the next thing you know, Breitbart, he's gone.
I understand he was as red as a lobster that just come out of the pot when they found him.
Really?
That's what they say. Now, that could be just urban legend, but that has been reported by a number of sources. And if you look at what happened to Michael Hastings, he's supposed to have been on the phone with Jennifer, what's her name, the WikiLeaks lawyer girl.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was heading for her house, and there are several cameras apparently caught this. But again, how much of it is faked? How much of it is real? But it appears that if this thing is genuine, it's like, oh, there's the primary charge. Woo, there's the gas tank. Wow, there's the main charge. So there were three separate little explosions, each progressively bigger.
Because
mm-hmm. Mercedes-Benzes don't just, they don't just explode like that when they hit something, especially since the front of the car wasn't burned either. You know, it's like, come on. The gas tank exploded, and it was a front-end collision.
That's strange.
I mean, we had some parking garage collapse close by. And a bunch of cars fell like seven stories. None of them exploded. You know?
Yeah.
So this guy hits a tree and it explodes? No.
Well, you know, I've got to tell you, I had a Jimmy. No, it was a Bravo. And 5 o'clock in the morning, I get a knock on the door and I can't figure out what's going on. And you hear there's a woman, she's yelling. She said, your car is on fire. I get out there, the car is on fire, the whole back end is engaged, the fire department's out trying to get it out, it didn't set it on fire, or it didn't explode, and the guy looked at me, he said, I'm just going to mark it down that it was just an engine, you know, accident fire like that. The engine was not even touched,
mm-hmm.
but it ate the car up and the car next to it. But it didn't explode.
Yeah, perfect.
So, and that, they build cars a lot better than what they used to, so they don't explode.
Mm-hmm. Isn't it the truth? Yeah, I mean, if you're talking about something made between the 30s and like 1951, or maybe even later than that, yeah, you get a rollover and a spark or something, the gas tank explodes, yeah, fine, but... But we've made some progress since those days, I'm pretty
Thank
sure, you
goodness.
Know.
But you notice all these astronomers, the people that are working with the bankers, all these people are dying right and left. And
yeah, how about all those bankers, that rash of banker suicides? They just all decided to jump off the top of the buildings that they worked in. Bye-bye.
Yeah. And the astronomers, they're dropping. The people working with the genome engineering, they're dropping. There's just something there, and it's just at the tip of the fingers, but you just can't grasp exactly what they're up to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a very dangerous, it's like Voltaire said, and, you know, it's dangerous to be right when the government is wrong,
mm-hmm.
and it's true, it really is. So, I mean, I don't know what kind of timeline anybody's on who is trying to investigate this stuff, but it would be nice if the people that we're talking to would like take some action so that we're just not, you know, like the fool as depicted on the tarot card. This is tooting the horn, and the next step he's going to go off the precipice. I mean, I don't. you know, it's like, well, what do you fear? It's like, well, I think it's like getting myself whacked out, and then instead of somebody saying it was a noble fight, they say something like, "What a dumbass," you know what I mean?
Right.
That's what I don't want.
I don't want that either.
And then they forget about you about 5 minutes later.
Oh, well, you went down to Dealey Plaza on the 50th anniversary of JFK's assassination, and you and Alex Jones and some others, you had your own run-ins with some of the, what I call the men in black, the government officials.
Well, no, that was two separate incidents. When I went down there to, it was so funny. We met at the Belo Park, which is I worked with Belo Broadcasting that had an AM and FM and a TV upstairs and newspaper right over there across the driveway for 25 years. But I never knew about Belo Park. Anyway, it's a nondescript little park there in the middle of downtown. And here comes Alex with this big entourage of people. And they march around the whole perimeter of the thing. And then they make another lap. And it's almost like, I mean, it looked almost like the Jonathan Winter show, you know, where there all sorts of stuff is marching behind him, you know, including the washing machine because he's crazy. But so we're standing at a distance. We're about 50 feet away from him, and Alex calls out, "Oh, there's Johnny Wells from Coast to Coast AM." It's like, so I came over there and popped off and began immediately indicting people that I'd formerly worked for. But that's neither here nor there to me because, of course, there was the Waco situation and the so-called live feed,
mm-hmm.
which curiously had edits in it. As I'm watching this, I'm going, how can it be live?
Yeah.
And I knew all those people down there. It's like, how can it be live and yet it's edited?
Can't do that.
And then later on, I saw the unedited version, and it was way different than what the people saw. I'll just leave it at that. But anyway, he comes over there, and I'm saying, these people ought to be ashamed of themselves, and blah, 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 you know, just popping off. I wish it had been a little more tasteful, but it wasn't. I didn't think it was in good taste, but it was how I felt, so I guess the chips will have to fall where they may.
Mm-hmm.
So we're walking down there toward the ceremony is taking place right there by Dealey Plaza, and the cops are being mildly antagonistic, not overtly ugly or anything, but they're like, "This is Officer So-and-so of the Dallas Police Department. You know, you're obstructing traffic." And it's like, somebody was saying, "Come on, pal, you're the one that's obstructing traffic. We're on the sidewalk. We're just crossing the street, you know?" So he was like, "Yeah, I know, but I got to do this." He didn't say that, but that was the look on his face. So we kept going. The Glee Club, Navy Glee Club sings and blah, 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 and people give it a little speech and all of that. Glee Club's up on a screen. I don't know where they were singing from. Maybe they were there and they just projected them up on the screen. There were so many people down there, I couldn't really tell. I just knew the Glee Club was singing.
Mm-hmm.
And suddenly, Mr. Bollinger, who, by the way, has just as a side note, he's got another cancer series that people would do well to avail themselves of an opportunity to view this. And you can go to caravan-to-midnight.com and find the link there, take it right to it. All it takes is an email address. Don't cost nothing except the email address. And you can view this thing, and it may really help you. And you talk about somebody that's being harassed for what he's doing. Oh, my gosh. I mean, his Facebook page gets taken down. You can't believe what he is a solid guy. He really is. There is no hint of anything wrong with this guy. He's a solid family man. His family is lovely. I know them all personally, and that's just how it is.
Mm-hmm.
And his brother's down there. The three of us are there, right? I just wanted to toss that in, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And suddenly Ty goes, "Let's go." And I went, "Really?" Because I was thinking, I wouldn't mind that because it's kind of cold out here, frankly. We've been out here for 2.5 hours. And he goes, "Yeah, I'm hungry. We've seen it all, and it's going to wind down, and we're going to have traffic and everything. Let's go eat." And so I looked at his brother. His brother looked at me, and we looked at Ty. I was like, "Okay, let's go." Well, about 2 minutes later, apparently, we got a call from a guy that used to try and help us out with guests and stuff. And he said, "Man, it's getting ugly down here. I'm just telling you, it's like the deputies are shoving people around like you wouldn't believe. Somebody fell down, almost busted this little girl's head, and it's stupid." And Alex was telling him, "You know, you better back off, you know, better back off. Okay, they're not backing off. Let's get ready to get it on." He didn't say that. It was a little stronger, but I'll spare you the repeating of it, and I'll spare your audience what he actually said. But it was like, "Let's whip some fill in the blank."
Right.
So we were oblivious to this, right? the Men in Black deal happened either the next day or 2 days after I was released from Coast to Coast. And I just had gone over to a building that I'll just say for the sake of security, that it was familiar to me. And at one point, I mean, I see this one guy looking around all over the place and looking here and there, and one of them's checking the gate to see if he can get in. And I said, "Can I help you?" And man, this guy just unleashed a torrent of not very well delivered, not very practiced obscenities and insults.
Mm-hmm.
And he's black shirt. Black pants, black shoes, black tie. He didn't have his jacket on, though. The other guy, black coat, black tie, black pants, all this. And these dudes were just, you couldn't even really get mad at them because they were so bad at hurling these insults. So I was very diplomatic, and I said, "Well, you can say whatever you like, but if you approach me, this is going to be the worst day of your life." And that goes for the midget, too, okay? I like to negotiate from a position of strength, right?
Right.
So it's like, I'll call the police. I said, "Call them. I'll wait." Well, he abandoned that idea. So I got with the, we'll just call him the superintendent of the property after these guys fled the scene, and this old explorer. And I said, "Who are these guys?" So he went around to the entire building and asked if anybody met this description. And the answer was no. And they both looked like they could have been Middle Easterners, but not quite. It was just a slightly darker complexion than a Caucasian complexion. And one of them had a little mustache. He reminded me a little bit of Saddam Hussein. But I just thought it was odd because nobody knew who they were. Nobody knew anybody like this. Nobody saw anything, and we never saw them again. So whether they were real Men in Black or not, I don't know, but it was obvious from what they were looking at that they were looking for me.
Well, did you ever find out exactly why? With what they were saying to you, were you able to tell anything that they might be after?
No, not at all. It went from, it's almost as though because I surprised them, they went to plan B, which was to just make it look as though it was just a random verbal altercation rather than anything of substance, because I think what they were hoping was that they could catch me, they could gain access and catch me inside this particular office, and then of course try and get in, which they always do. And if you're ever approached by these people, all you have to do is tell them no, and you will see the most awkward demonstration of resenting the fact that you will not let them in. They will not necessarily get loud, but they just become really fidgety and uncomfortable about this because they're like grown-up little kids that aren't getting their way. It's really weird.
Hmm.
Now, Anthony Patch, the guy that was talking about CERN and the Large Hadron Collider and all of that, who went on a speaking tour for a while and then was approached by a couple of guys in nice suits. And he said, "These guys look like Ken dolls." He said, They were kind of a match, and they just said, "You know, this is really good material, really really good stuff that you're talking about here, and we'd like for you to stop talking about it. Do we make ourselves clear?" And then they just left, and they had been sitting there quietly listening, and they'd look at him and they'd smile, and then when he was finished delivering his presentation, they approached him. So they don't all look like these, you know, pasty faced guys like the ones everybody's seen on YouTube where they're walking into the hotel and they look kind of like they've got almost like gorilla masks with that have been spray painted a pasty gray.
Right.
They don't all look like that. Who they work for, I don't know. I wouldn't even speculate, but I don't think they work on behalf of the citizenry, I'll put it that way.
Well, I know the Hagmans have had problems with them, and quite a few of their guests have had problems. And that they said on a show just within the last few days that there's some kind of attack that's going on with the broadcasters and the media, that they're trying to get to the bottom of it. But, yeah, they don't want the truth out, and they'll use intimidation in any way they can to stop it.
Yeah, they will. And the thing is, if it would be pretty easy at this point for I'm going to say I'm not going to state this as if it's a fact. It's that I would think that this would put a lot of people off and make them want to not have anything to do with this investigative or investigative journalism, if you want to call it that, mm-hmm. or conspiracy busting, or let alone systems busting, which is really what we're involved in. But it's enough to make people want to just go, look, you know what, I don't want any part of this. But here's the thing. I don't remember who said this. Maybe it was Machiavelli. Maybe it was Sun Tzu. Maybe it was, who's the other guy that wrote The Five Rings? Musashi. You may not be interested in war, but war is very interested in you. Mm. And it's the same thing with this. You may not be interested in these conspiracies and the danger that comes from investigating them, if there is some, and I suspect that there is. But this danger, you're involved in that danger. It makes no difference whether you investigate conspiracy theories or not. If you're a citizen and you're not with them, then they consider you to be against them, and
that's right.
Their view of the world is that you will not prevail. They will. You won't.
And the thing is, though, if you are called to do this, you do it. You don't tell God no. If he says this is what you're being called to do and I want you to do it, then you do it. I would rather go against the government than go against God any day.
Well, again, I think I said this at the beginning of our conversation. They don't want you to have a family that you can be loyal to.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want you to have a Lord that you're loyal to. They want you to be loyal to them. They want you to do what you're told, and they want you to shut up about it. Just do it. Here's your pittance. Here's your dole. And go on vacation now. Have a good time. And just shut up. Don't talk about this anymore.
Right.
You know, you're not going to help anything. You're not going to change anything. But here's the other part. It's written in Scripture that 10,000 can fall to one hand and 1,000 to the other hand, but it will not come nigh thee. If you have the Lord's protection, you have it. That's it.
Amen.
It's inviolate. It isn't like sometimes you have it and then he's going to change his mind. No, 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 no. Your days are numbered like the hairs on your head are numbered. And he's the only one that knows, which is why it's been written in a couple of things. Maybe it was Shakespeare, maybe it was Julius Caesar, whatever. But, oh, how lucky is it for a man to know the hour of his departure from planet Earth, paraphrasing Shakespeare pretty badly. But, you know, if you just live your life without worry and you just do what you feel, you believe that you're called to do, then why worry about it? Just go forward. None of this is our stuff. You know, people might have a little bit of trouble getting their minds around this. I mentioned this on a program recently, but I tend to do two things. One of them is repeat stories, and the other one is to oversell a little bit. But Henry Ford, it's like, oh, who cares about an old white guy? Well, let me tell you why you should care about him. Because he was the first one. You look at his factory, and over there at that end is a big pile of dirt. A pile of dirt big enough to delight any little boy. Oh, look, we can make a giant fort out of this dirt. And then there are these buildings that go for a long ways. Can't really see what's going on in there. Let's look into the end. Oh, look, there are conveyor belts carrying dirt in. Wonder what they do in there. Wow, what are those? Wow, those are furnaces. Look, they're heating up the dirt until it turns into what is effectively lava. And what's that stuff they're scraping off the top? Oh, they call that slag. That's the impurities. And out of the other, and what's this farther down? I hear guys talking and hammers and tools and machines and stuff. What is this? So on one end of the factory is a big pile of dirt, and out of the other end of the factory rolls out a brand new car. And its point of origin was that pile of dirt. It contained iron ore. They separated it from the rest, got rid of the slag, made the steel, put it into the presses, beat it out, and voila, there's your automobile. And the whole point is that none of this is our stuff. That beautiful car over there started off as a pile of dirt, which is part of the earth, which is a creation of God.
Right.
So if you understand that none of this is our stuff, we, our bodies, this is not our stuff. I don't remember sitting down and going, I'll take that body and I'll just float my consciousness right into it, which I also invented on my own. No. That's not what happened.
No.
So
that's
when you come to grips with it. Well, that's how you come to grips. That's how I came to grips with my own reality. It's like none of this stuff is ours. None of it. You can't point to anything and go, that's mine. No, it's not. You can be a custodian of it for a while. You can say you own it. You've got a deed or you've got this or that. You can pass it down to your progeny, whatever you want.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't own any of it. It's on loan to you from your creator. And it's to your creator that you owe your allegiance. And they say, glory, oh, glory be to God. It's like, well, if the word glory is too strong for you, if the first thing that comes to your mind is like the stars and stripes waving in the breeze, well, go look it up. It's respect. It's credit. It's admiration. We say all the glory goes to God. Well, in this day and age, the word glory is kind of an out-of-place word. But it's no less an important word or an appropriate word.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a little time-worn, and we don't know what it means. Oh, glory, the TV series that's about the black guys fighting the Civil War. Forget about that. That's just more brainwashing. That's just stuff that sticks in your head, and it changes the way that you look at stuff. Old glory is waving in the breeze. Old glory? Who named it that? Okay. I mean, it's okay, but that's not what it means. When you say glory to God in the highest, it just means you have to give kudos to the Creator who did all of this. That's all. So that's the one thing Barack Obama's come up with is completely correct. You know, if you built a business, you didn't do that. Somebody else did that. Yeah, and I'll tell you who it was, too. It was God Almighty. Praise Him in the name of the Lord Jesus. And it wasn't anybody else.
Amen.
And you got to participate in it. And that's just how it is. And I had no idea that I was going to wind up preaching a good bit of the time. I mean, I had no plans to start a mega church and enrich myself with lots of the following. Just filling up those plates with money, you know. That's not my game plan. It's just that I really believe this, Kay. I really believe that where this country messed up was that we decided, hey, everything's pretty sweet. We don't need God anymore. Well, tell that to the poor sap that was out there in a rice paddy all shot to pieces and hoping that somebody medevacs him out of there.
That's right.
In an undeclared war for some banker dude somewhere who hides behind, as Bob Dylan wrote, hides behind desks and walls. Masters of war. Unbelievable.
I've always thought that you should take, if there's two countries that have a difference and they want to fight, let them fight. But take the person that's running the one country and the other person running the country, stick them in a boxing ring. Don't take the lives of our men and our women. There's no point in that.
Yeah, I said on one of the caravan programs, I just said, get your wrinkly backside out there. Let's see how you do. Go ahead. You're perfectly all right. See, when people make war, they really make, when nations make war, they really make war on themselves. They send their best looking, their brightest people out there, the ones that are the most fit, the most in shape. They send their most masterful inventions. And their slickest machinery and their most powerful, groovy, very cool weapons and all that. And what happens? You either destroy the other guy's stuff or he destroys your stuff. Well, what do you do when you go to war with a nation? You destroy their wealth.
Yes.
However, when you consider that 90%, as I mentioned earlier, of all the casualties in a war are civilian, and this was what my conversation with myself last night was about, really. It was just a reiteration of the fact that the reason that that is a verifiable statistic is because the people allow it. If the people, you know, it's the old hippie poster. What if they gave a war and nobody came?
That's right. There would be no war.
It's up to us. If people want to know why is the world so messed up, go look in the mirror. I'm sorry, it's a harsh reality, but it's true.
It is.
It's us. We did it. we did it the same way, or we didn't do it the same way that I didn't take that picture, in the same way that somebody didn't vote, somebody didn't protest, somebody, in the words of Solzhenitsyn, nobody sang out. They're arresting me for nothing. They're taking me away. Somebody help me. Everybody stay quiet. When Solzhenitsyn said, instead of quivering in the dark, waiting for the secret police to come and knock the door in, we should have grabbed anything. A screwdriver, you know,
right.
A can opener, whatever was handy. And make these people understand that every time you go out on your rounds, you may not get back home to your family. He also said, we didn't love freedom enough.
Ooh, that's deep.
I mean, it's enough to make you cry. We cannot let this happen because somebody's got a suit or a car or an entourage or a limousine or title or office or anything else. We cannot let this happen. We cannot let them destroy our families, and most assuredly, we cannot let them compromise our faith through drugs, propaganda, electromagnetic radiation, or whatever they have, because you communicate, you teach yourself how to pray, you ask to be taught how to pray, and you will be taught. And when you have, and I've heard preachers say this, and I thought, oh, rubbish, shut up. Well, no, it's me who should have shut up, because it's true. When you establish that relationship, when you realize, when you fly in a plane and you realize one person can set all of that ground down there either in greenery that's lush and brings forth fruit, or can turn it into a sea of fire. When you understand that, then you also begin to understand that, yes, you can communicate with the Great One, the creator of all this. Now, I have to qualify that by saying Steve Quayle said that a lot of Satanists refer to the Great One as the devil. It's like, I'm not talking about the devil.
No.
I reject the devil in the name of the Christ Jesus. I'm saying it on your show,
amen.
And I do. And I probably sound like a lunatic to some people. Well, so be it. This is me. This is me. For better or worse, this is it. Am I a sinner? Pfft, an idiot sinner. Recidivistic maniac. Well, maybe not that, but it'll do till the maniac gets here. But you know what? After a while, you grow up and you go, wait, I was on the wrong track here. And now I've got regret because I should have paid closer attention. But when you understand, you really can. You, one little person, no, you don't have great works or great wealth or anything else. You're just a person. Well, you're a creation of Father, and you can talk to him. But the rule is, you have to go through his son. Why?
Sorry.
Well, because the janitor does not go up to the top floor of the office building, toss the boss's coat over onto the couch, sit down, put his feet up on the desk, and ask what's going on. It's called respect, protocol. Oh, I know. Glory. Credit. Recognition.
Mm-hmm.
Respect. You can have... It's the expression is so time-worn that I just hesitate to use it, Kay, but it is, you can have a personal relationship, personal, one-on-one. He already knows every skeleton in your closet. He knows what you're going to do before you do it.
That's right.
Before you do. He knows more, way more about you than you do. He knows everything about you. You can't hide. You can't lie. You can't. And once you recognize this, you go, I'm yours. I don't belong to me. I belong to you. And I'm not just saying it. I really mean it.
Amen. You just give it all up to him. You just give
you
yourself
do, and, just say,
and everything around you. Like you said, nothing is ours.
But some people hate themselves. And like a child who refuses, who messes up, and his parent gives the child a scolding and says, okay, we're over that. Now let's have some cake and ice cream. And the child is... It's like, no, I don't want any. Well, the child does want it, but now it's going to punish itself by refusing the cake that it wants because it's got guilt over what it's did, what it's done. You let all that go when you believe in the Lord Jesus. That's gone.
That's so true.
It doesn't mean that you don't have to live with the consequences of your actions. It just means as far as the actual offense, you may have to deal with other men about it. Yeah, you're going to have to do 3 years or whatever it is, you know. But... you're not going to have to do an eternity separated from your Father.
And it's a wonderful feeling of, I hate to use the word, but I would say liberation. that you know that when you give it to God, that you no longer have that on your back. It's a feeling of relief. It's a feeling of thankfulness, and it's just so huge.
Well said. Yes, the enemy wants people to think that belief in the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, that this is some kind of slavery, that you're in some kind of bondage, that you're a prisoner trapped in these archaic notions. But that's not what it's about at all. Mm-hmm. It's about freedom, freedom the likes of which so many people have not experienced. And there are a lot of people out there that are determined to keep you from experiencing it too. And all of this is written in Scripture. That was just written. That's just a comic book. It's like, no, it's not. It's the most. People say, I don't want to hear about Jesus. I want to hear about the paranormal. It's like, you're going to tell me there's something more paranormal about existence itself? You're going to tell me there's something more paranormal or as paranormal as what's written in Scripture? You're kidding yourself.
That's what I always say. There is nothing more supernatural than the Bible and God. There's
everything
that can
in there.
Exceed that.
No, they exceed it. There's nothing that can match
it.
Quantum mechanics, quantum physics, telepathy, multidimensional beings, all of that stuff, it's all in there. Now, it's written in a language that you're not used to. I made a comment on the program, and I really was hoping that the message I was trying to send was clear. I can't remember who I was talking to, which is normal, but it was like, I wish that the churches would stop leaning on the, it's the good news. It's like, listen, no offense, but we've heard that. After a while, if you keep saying the same things over and over again, sometimes they don't make as much of an impression on people as you think they're going to. So could you just explain that what you call an angel, how about an interdimensional messenger sent from the Creator? Instead of just lumping it into angel.
Awesome.
Oh, look, it's an angel tree. Look, it's a hell's angel. It's a... Let's just take that out of the lexicon for a minute. An interdimensional messenger from the Creator himself. Will that work? Well, yeah, it puts a little different spin on it. You bet it does.
Sure does.
And it's no less the case. A rose by any other name smells as sweet, right?
Yeah.
I'm just saying here.
Well, and if they tell the truth, it would... People go in and all they hear is the good things. And the Bible, it takes everything and turns it for our good and His glory. But if people would really get into the heart of the Bible and tell what's really there and the whole picture instead of just the sugar coating, I think there would be a much bigger impact and a drawing of people.
Yes, you're right, and I would add this too, and I'm sure Mr. Ghost would agree with me. I have to tell you that Mr. Ghost is somebody who's very, very near and dear to me. People who are members of Caravan to Midnight, they know who he is. But we had a discussion about this, and he said, "Read Timothy. Read Timothy. It won't take you very long. Just read it." And you'll find out that this thing about picking the right church and the right message and what you have to do, what you have to be a proper preacher, pastor, minister, whatever. You know, those are all names for the same things,
mm-hmm.
right? Or for the same thing. It's important. The enemy is everywhere. Everywhere. In everything. In this earthly realm. And when it says, be thou continuously in prayer, it's like... Instantly, what comes into an American's mind, I would guess, would be like, oh, so I'm supposed to go around with my head bowed and bumping into stuff and not doing it. No, that's not what it means. Mm-hmm. What it means is stay on the spiritual wave. Keep that receiver turned on. It'll guide you through stuff that you will otherwise go bumping into like a little mechanical man that cannot help what it is doing. And it just goes banging into stuff. That's Anthony Burgess when he was writing about how Alex was as a destructive teenager that's going out doing crime. He says, I'm like one of these wind-up little mechanical men that you buy on the street.
Right.
It goes idiot-ing off on its own. It just crashes into things, and it cannot help what it is doing. Without spiritual guidance, you cannot help what you are doing. And I'm going to leave it there because otherwise it's going to get old on somebody's ears. But it's like, think about it, people, because we're running out of time here. These may not be the end days. They may not. But I would submit to you that they'll sure do until the end days get here. And if these people have their way, and if this stuff is true, it's not all going to just blow over.
No.
There are people who are determined to eliminate about 6.5 billion out of the 7 billion that supposedly occupy this planet. You have such a retarded school system now, the people are actually beginning to float the flat earth theory again.
Yes, I'm so sick of hearing the flat earth, not saying about you bringing it up, but to me it's a ridiculous topic.
Kay, you are perfectly at liberty to upbraid me on any subject anytime you wish. In fact, you'd be doing me a favor if you did, probably. Just saying.
That would be hard for me to do, I think.
I mean, we're not advancing. We're retarding. And people say, you can't say retarded. Of course you can. Retardation is you either retard the timing, if you know how to manipulate a distributor on a V8 or any kind of internal combustion engine other than a lawnmower that has a distributor on it, you either advance the timing or you retard the timing. Retardation just means you're not advancing, and in some cases you're going the other way.
Right.
But, you called him a retard. It's like, well, his thinking is retarded. It's not advanced at all. He's making no progress.
Mm-hmm. And you're not
That's
making
retarded.
A comment on a group of people. You're making a statement as far as what the word means and how a person is reacting according to that definition.
Exactly. My father always said, look it up. And it was always like, oh, Dad, can't you just tell me what it means? It's like, I didn't ever speak to him that way. He was a Navy man, an ex-submariner. They call the watch a submariner, but they call themselves submariners. But he's a tough, well-educated Navy man. I suspect had a much more serious history than we ever suspected, because if there was ever a man who could keep a secret, that would be my dad. And tough as a railroad spike, 6'2", about 175 pounds his whole life, and just an amazing guy. But he would always say, go look it up. And it was many years later that I realized the value of that. It's like, I can give you a colloquial description of a definition, but if you will go to a trusted source and read the definition, then you will have the true definition.
And it sticks with you. My great aunt did that with me, too. And it made a really big impact. If I didn't know a word or understand something, I looked it up. And you don't forget it.
You know, so many things have been, in some ways, inspired. I think I really believe they were divinely inspired. My dad would do things like, he would say, we're going to learn some multiplication tables today. I'm like, okay. Okay, we're going to do 9. The first one he started on was 9, which is regarded as a holy number by some in the world because it's the only number that behaves the way it does. Any multiple of 9, whether it's 2 times 9 or 3 or 5 or whatever, you add those numbers up and they condense to 9. 81, 72, 63, 54, 45, whatever, 36, 27, 18. And the word that he wanted, I mean, I was like in first grade. He decided he wanted me to learn how to spell. The first word that my dad ever got me to spell was Constitution. You believe that?
Wow.
So help me, as I live and breathe, it's the truth.
That's cool.
And I didn't realize the significance of this until later. And I'm convinced, because my dad kind of became an extraordinarily educated and just a brilliant man, but a regular Henry David Thoreau who pretty much turned his back on contemporary society. He really did. He was a handsome man. He was a tough man. I saw him slip and hold the, so help me. And that was the first time I remember calling out the name of Jesus, and he was right there with a flock of angels because we had attempted to put a motorcycle into the back of a 1970 Ford pickup truck with a real narrow bed,
mm-hmm.
and it was jacked up, one of those silly-looking things, that toolboxes on the side and all that. I don't know where Dad got it, but he liked it. And it was quite a high bed off the ground. And we're trying to bring the CBX Honda up there. That's a 6-cylinder motorcycle. You know, you could practically use the motor as a fairing in the winter and be behind this nice warm engine. And he didn't like expressions. He didn't even like the word, yeah. He just thought that was improper. And, of course, it is. And he did not like that. And, you know, if anybody used any of the language that's commonly used today, and you know which ones they are, he'd just look at you like you were the lowest form of scum that ever existed.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, he was also a tough Navy man who was a Pearl Harbor veteran attacked on the USS Maryland, a battleship with which my grandfather, after whom I am named, actually helped build.
Oh, wow.
Okay. It's outrageous. So I said, Dad, you're on the right side of the bike now, and that's the front brake, so don't squeeze it too tight if it starts to go the wrong way, or you'll lock it up and it'll come off. And he didn't even like lock it up. He thought that was just, you know, burn out, peel out, you know, slamming gears kind of language. He didn't like any of that. Well, that's what happened, and he fell. And I said, oh, Jesus, Jesus. And I came around the corner, and my dad is not even completely on his side. He's on his elbow, and his other arm is extended, and he is holding this motorcycle by the side of the engine with his outstretched arm and his palm.
Oh.
And this thing had to be around 600 pounds. Totally impossible. But he did it, and I witnessed it. I saw it. And people think, oh, man, you're crazy. You're smoking wacky weed or you're drinking. I am not. I was there. And, of course, the next time that I called out the name of the Lord Jesus, when I crashed a motorcycle around 70 miles an hour at 10 o'clock in the morning on a Monday, I'm coming up on my 6th-year anniversary of being literally, in the spiritual sense, reborn. And I was. And I don't care who hears it, and I don't much care what anybody thinks about it.
Praise
it happened.
God.
I lived it. Absolutely. I called out the name of the Lord, and it was like, let me show you something, pal. You're dead. You know that. Yes. Now look. You're not. You understand? Yes. I'm not convinced you completely understand. Come with me, Junior. May I ask where we're going? We're going to the desert for a while. And we did. And I tell the story the same way and use the same words every time because there aren't, in other words, those are the words. And that was the beginning of a 2-year epiphany that has not stopped since. It's just one thing after another. But here's the thing. My favorite preacher is Charles Stanley,
mm-hmm.
First Baptist Church of Atlanta. He's an old man, a grandfather, a fatherly figure, somebody that you could only hope to have in your neighborhood. But, of course, he's one of a kind. And he said something very interesting one time. He said, you know, people, oh, God, save me. Oh, God, please help me. He goes, so you got your help. Your problem's gone. That's like, okay, fine. Don't need God anymore. Don't do that. If you feel like your connection, once you teach yourself, and you'll go through all of this, you'll go through, is this you talking to me or is this me talking to me? Am I just playing here? And you'll find out. But you have to want to do it. You have to decide, this is important to me. And then do it. And then, once you have learned how to hear and actually how to pray and how to approach the Lord in prayer, then after that, you may find that you start slipping into that thing that Dr. Stanley discussed, and you go and you say, Lord, I feel like my connection's getting a little rusty here, a little corroded, something's going on. I don't feel a tight circuit here. I feel like I'm slipping off the grid or something. I don't feel like my communication with you is clear. Well, that's intention. Nothing happens in this universe without intention. It is your intention to restore that connection, and it will be restored. But you have to mean it. You cannot con God. You cannot second-guess life, and you cannot outsmart God. Take that off the table. It ain't even worth pondering for a moment. It's impossible. You can't do it.
No.
So, anyway, look, I'm going on and on here, and I appreciate you letting me bend your ear on your program.
Oh, you're great. You said that. That was very well said. And, you know, John, I could sit and listen to you for hours because I've done it.
Bless you. Thank you so much for that. I really mean this when I say I'm just happy that the Lord gave me a skill because I was a regular freewheeling Franklin there for a while, and it was just all it did was just, you know, the more let's say party notches that I put on the gun of life or whatever,
mm-hmm.
the more miserable and unfulfilled I became. It's just the way it was. I mean, after you've been a borderline hedonist. And you go, well, looking at it now, I'd say that was a completely empty experience. You know, not everything, but some of the things that you get into when you have a license to do pretty much what you want, you know?
Right.
For a while. But unless you completely abandon your character and you completely abandon your conscience, which is the silver strand to the great one, you're eventually going to turn away from those things and go, okay. That's why when the Lord says, look, everybody sins, it's understood that you're going to sin. It is under, and a sin is nothing more than a mistake. Well, sin is sin. No, not really. You know, calling somebody a name and telling them, you know, this, that, and the other, and murdering somebody, those are both sins, but I would submit that one is more serious than the other, you know.
Right.
But is that really true? Wrong is wrong. On another level, wrong is wrong. And I tell you, once you learn how to say no, oh, I really don't want to face this. It's just, I just feel like I shouldn't go along with this. You know, once you learn how to say no, I'll guarantee you the next time's easier. And the time after that, easier still.
It is.
And you learn that there are some things you're going to accept, and there are some things that you're not going to accept. But don't lean on, this is straight out of Scripture, do not lean on your own understanding. It is limited.
Mm-hmm.
You must rely on the Lord, and you must read your Bible.
You know, a lot of people that I know have heard me say this before, but I'm a person that I don't worry, because I know God has got everything under control. And if there's something going on, people have seen me actually stop, and I'll look up and raise my hands and say, God, I give it to you. This is out of my hands, and I don't have that worry. And to be blessed to be able to do a radio ministry to me is such a great gift that he's given me that I don't even have the words to be able to thank him as much as I want to. Just the way he touches my life.
There's no way to impress him.
No.
It's impossible to impress him. It may be even very difficult to please him. He says about his son, Yehoshua, this is my son with whom I am well pleased. So for humans, the object is you may not be able to please him, but you can please him by trying to not displease him.
Oh, perfect. Yes.
You know, you cannot impress Father. Because, I mean, you talk about been there and done that. He's the creator of the universe, which is why I have such a hard time with people who write books like Lawrence Krauss did, who turns out to be a friend of Jeffrey Epstein, the famous pedophile and pimp. A universe from nothing. I have trouble living down to myself, allowing this guy to just go on and on a coast-to-coast program I was on because it was so stupid. You know, now, and maybe it's just as well. I mean, maybe that's a lesson that I need to learn, because now this guy wouldn't have gotten 6 feet into that territory before he was advised, don't look now, pal, but you're standing on a landmine, and I don't think you're going to be able to step off of it. So I'm going to go ahead and excuse myself now, and you deal with it, since I told you not to go in there in the first place, okay? Well, it says minefield right there. What were you thinking? Did you not read? Yeah, you know, before anything can burst out, that's like saying the universe is so cool, insert bong bubbling noise here, that it's so cool it invented itself.
Yeah.
Let me up, you know?
Yeah.
It's rubbish. I'm sorry. Your work is rubbish.
Oh, it's like the scientist. He gets so excited. He tells God, he says, God, you've got to see this. I've created life. And God shows up, and he's working, and the scientist says, see, here, look, I take this, and I take that, and he takes some dirt, and God looks at him. He says, put my dirt back. Because God is the ultimate creator. You just can't do it.
He'll let us play it in his world. But but I repeat, he'll let us play in his world.
Mm-hmm.
But when he gets enough of something, it will stop. And if people will think, folks, it is possible to love each other, it doesn't mean that we like each other. But as one of my favorite people, remember Bishop Sheen?
Yes.
He said, there are many things that people don't like. And he goes, fat women in tweeds. And it was so funny because he was just a regular guy who would just say stuff that other people were thinking, but they wouldn't dare say it. And he just said, you know, if you will just allow yourself to love them, before long you'll realize that you like them too. Beautiful. Why is it that we are compelled into conflict? Why? It is the dark one who causes this. The dark one is the father of lies.
Yeah.
It says in Scripture, the reason he flooded the earth the first time is, you know, he was sorry that he made it. He's like, I'm sorry that I created this. I really am. I'm going to undo it. Well, he can do what he wants. He's the creator. He's over there somewhere. I don't know where he is. Oh, that's right. He's everywhere.
Yes, he is.
You know, so it's like, folks, if ever there was a time when faith is required, it's now. If you don't have any, get some. You're going to need it, because faith will get you through what's coming way better than boxes of MREs and your deer rifle and all your web gear and a bunch of ammo, and you're out there. You won't make it 2 weeks.
No.
You're going to have to be guided by the Lord, or you're not going to make it. And I mean that, and I mean it with everything that I am.
The armor of God is the best you can have.
It doesn't get as good as that, let alone better. Mm-hmm. So yeah, and I want people to make it, Kay. I want them to make it. I want them to. There's nothing in it for me, for somebody else, to come to the Lord. That's on them. I'm just saying that if I say anything that makes somebody reexamine their life and decide, you know, I may be messing up here. I may need to look at this again. Well, then that's a good thing. And maybe that will be something that may not please Father, but it will not displease him. You know, maybe that is between me saying it and somebody reacting to it and going, yeah, I want to get close to Father. I do believe. I am a screw up. I can't help it. I need help.
Right.
I let go of who I am. I, it ain't working. Well, that's a good thing. I think it is. I believe that it is. And maybe he thinks it's a good thing, too. I don't know his mind, but I'm thinking he might think that's a good thing.
He wants everyone to wake up.
Well, we're getting on a short timeline here, and you know, the forces of evil are gathering. And you know, for example, I mean, as much as I admire the fact that Putin seems to be a straight shooter. I thought his delivery at the United Nations was right on. He's going, well, what do you think these ISIS guys are? They're mercenaries. They fight for whoever pays them the most money. Who's paying them? You know, they take over the oil fields. Who do you think's buying the oil? Do you think they, meaning the U.S., they don't know that it's their allies that are buying the oil? He's like, do you have no common sense? But at the same time, some people will say, listen, in fact, I said it. It's like when I was talking with the attorney. Don't get pulled into the cult of personality, because Vlad Putin is a tough cat, and he has his national interests first, and that really pretty much says it all, meaning that your national interests are second. His national interests are first. But let what's going on here illustrate the weakness of our own government, and then let us, as Americans, address that. We can't deal with the Russians and their government right now, but we can certainly deal with ours. And when you start seeing the White House lit up in homosexual rainbow colors, and you see the Supreme Court pushing an insurance program on us that is completely illegal, it was based on lies, and not only that, but it's going to be even more. Not only is it expensive now, by most people's rates have doubled, but they're going to go up again next year. And if you don't do your patriotic duty in providing health care for everyone, which of course is another lie, well, then they'll fine you for it. We need to put in some real leaders in there that will throw this into the trash where it belongs and put a government back together that will leave us alone.
Yes, I'm praying for this election, that we get someone in there that will take America back for us and with us.
Well, that's, yes, with us. But we can't be like the one who approached Ben Franklin and said, well, what kind of government have you given us? You don't get your freedom by asking nicely. You get your freedom by fighting for it and being worthy of it, by being good stewards of your freedom. But one of the worst things can happen, my father taught me this too, one of the worst things can happen to a young man or woman is to get a bunch of money while they're young. It'll ruin them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, well, it's the same thing about freedom. If you can't, oh, sure, we all laugh at the, you got to fight for your right to party. Okay, fine, ha-ha. Well, party? How about you have to fight for your rights? And we'll just leave it there.
I can't agree with you more, John.
It's not going to be handed to you. One time I saw a video game that said the United States of America didn't become the greatest country on earth by asking nicely. And I thought, that's actually true, but that's really kind of grim. And but it's not kind of true, it's completely true. And so I repeat, we have to fight for our freedom. It's not going to be given to us. If we leave it up to them and then walk up to them and say, well, what kind of government have you given us? You're liable to get an answer like, well, you've been given a council of demonically possessed psychopaths and you're going to live in misery for the length of your natural days, which won't be very long.
That's concerning.
We don't ask for what kind of government. We take it.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, Austin, I think this horse is glue. Yep, I'm pretty sure it's glue.
Oh, John, I love having you on. You're just an absolutely wonderful guest, and I can't put it into words how much I enjoy it. Look forward to it.
That's extremely kind of you. Thank you. Mutual.
Thank you. Would you like to give out the information how people can listen to Caravan to Midnight? And you've got some pretty cool products that people can order and just everything.
Well, I would be very happy to. It's Caravan to Midnight. People want to use numbers and they want to take some of the letters out of midnight, but it's just the words Caravan to Midnight with a T-O and an M-I-D-N-I-G-H-T. And it's a subscription service, which means that we are not subject to threats from sponsors saying, we didn't like that story that you talked about, so we're pulling our advertising. We're going to bankrupt you. It's like, nope, can't do that because our members support us. And as long as they like it, then we'll keep doing it. There's a lot of, if you go to the homepage, you can scroll down a little bit on the right and you'll see, you'll see all kinds of stuff. L.A. Marzulli has put out a special offer for people who, it's an outrageously excellent offer. Just check it out because the details escape me, but it's like he's got Watchers 9 out and Watchers 9 Days of Chaos is out and a year subscription to something that's delivered over the net. I'm not looking at it at this moment. I'm totally unprepared because I really didn't think you were going to ask me to do that. But anyway, also there's a link to Ty Bollinger's cancer series. All it takes is an email, and you can see it for free. If you scroll down some more, you'll find a button that'll take you to our YouTube channel, and you can see a good sizable sample of programs, so you can see if you like them or not. And then if you decide you want to be a member, $15 for 3 months. 30 for six, 60 for a year. And this is really true, Kay. It's like when you become a member of Caravan, you really become part of a force. I mean, for example, and I'll be brief on this, the Sandy Hook incident mm-hmm. is being exposed as a complete fraud, and it is.
Yeah.
The Dorches, a mild-mannered optometrist who wound up in jail for 30 days with all kinds of legal abuse, because it all started with his 12-year-old son spraying the word zero on a few places, which is the name of a skateboard company. And before it's all over with, they got SWAT team over there busting the door down and coming in and pulling stuff from all over the rooms and creating what they claim is some sort of a drug lab, which turned out to be just nothing. Then they destroyed their own evidence. And a couple of days after the lawyer and his wife came on the program, they let him out.
Yeah.
Also, this kid, Jonathan Reich, up in, I think he's up in New York, he just called to make an inquiry regarding the Sandy Hook shooting. By the time it's all over with, he's got $50,000, and they tried to charge him with telephone harassment, but it wasn't telephone harassment. He called one time and asked a question. Well, they're about to drop the charges on him, the South Africans, and there is a genocide going on in South Africa that your mainstream media will not report, but it's not black people who are being annihilated. It's white people. Yeah. They're sitting in squatters camp. They have an unbelievably oppressive regime. So a man that, and this was in our newsletter, which you can get for free also. Just put your name on the list and we'll send you one. Every time it comes out, usually once a month, unless I'm slacking, and then sometimes it can be 6 weeks, but I try not to slack. But the man got his wheelchair, and some funds are coming in to help people, and we've managed to extract a few families out of that situation. It's interesting that this country will bring in all the refugees from places whose culture is completely incompatible with ours, but trying to get light-skinned South Africans into this country is like, you know, pulling dinosaur teeth.
Makes no sense.
And what does that tell us? I mean, it's ridiculous. So when you join Caravan, we become more than just a program. I repeat, it's awareness, analysis, and then action.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're all about. And we're going to do it, and we're going to continue to do it. I'm going to do it as long as I've got my wind. I'll continue to do it, and if it ever comes time for me to pass the torch to somebody, I will. And but until then, we carry on Monday through Friday with a new program at 10 o'clock Central every night, Monday through Friday. So we hope you'll join us, because we'd love to have you. Now, I think you're gonna like being a part of it. There are hundreds of programs waiting in archive for you right now.
I absolutely love Caravan to Midnight. It's just,
well, thank you for that. I owe it all to the Lord, or it wouldn't be happening.
Amen.
I bought that domain name in 2006, had no idea what I was going to do with it. But now I do.
I've got to ask you, before we go, since you brought that up, how did you get the name of Caravan to Midnight?
Oh, come on. You don't want the magician to tell you how the trick's done, do you?
Oh, you can tell me, John. Come on. Nobody else will.
Well,
care.
I'll tell you what. Way back in the rock and roll days, now this is just for your show, okay?
Okay.
Back in the rock and roll days at the mighty KZEW-FM in Dallas, I had a listener that would call, because I was probably me and the overnight guy were virtually the only ones that answered the request lines. Everybody else just let them ring. I said, what are you doing? You know, I'll answer them. I answer them all day. I mean, what am I going to do other than sit and stand there like a moron smoking cigarettes while a four-minute record's playing all day? You know, you play 50 of them. And this person wanted to hear I'm Out to Get You by Robin Trower.
Oh.
And I said, okay, I'll try and find it. And I had no idea what album it was on. Nobody in there knew what album it was on. Of course, then again, they wondered what was wrong with me when I stripped off a piece of black cloth from a T-shirt and wrapped it around my arm the day that John, the next day after John Lennon got killed. They just couldn't figure out why I would do that. And I said, go away, get out of the studio before I throw you out.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't understand it, then it's there's no point in explaining it to you if you don't get it. Well, it turned out that it was on the Caravan to Midnight album from 1978. And I thought, well, that's a cool name. So I played this record, and it's a cool song. I played it on Coast to Coast many times.
Mm-hmm.
It's got this little do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. It's very groovy. And there's Jimmy Doers, you know, I'm out to get you, you know. And I thought, yeah, I am kind of out to get him. So anyway, I thought, so I listened to the rest of the record, and I thought, you know, usually there's some sort of a tie-in between the title and the content on the album, but in this case, I don't detect any connection. Of course, then again, Cream's Disraeli Gears, there's no real connection there either. So maybe I was just reaching for something, and it wasn't there. Kind of like trying to understand Jimi Hendrix lyrics on the first pass.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Totally impossible. So I just thought, Caravan to Midnight. Well, there was a club in Fort Worth called Caravan of Dreams. And I actually saw some great musical acts there, including John McLaughlin, a spectacular guitarist. And he had this guy in Treelock, somebody, that was this amazing percussionist. Unbelievable. So that club closed down a long time ago. People from North Texas would say, is this Caravan of Dreams? It's like, no, that's a club. It closed about 20 years ago. This is Caravan of Midnight. Hello, how can we help you? but anyway, I thought, you know, I'm going to buy that domain name. I do not know what I'm going to do with it. And then one night on Coast to Coast AM, I popped off and said, this is not my show. People have said, oh, we love your show. Well, it's not my show. This is a Premier Radio Networks product. I said that if I did have my own show, I would call it Caravan to Midnight. And I'd forgotten that I had actually bought that domain name.
Oh.
So as time went by, I would say, okay, the caravan to midnight starts on the count of one. One. And then the board operator would hit the thunderclap. And then, 2 years of being on Saturday nights, and the topics are getting a little bit strong for the tastes of the ones up on mm-hmm. corporate row. And so when the 28th came along and I got the word that I would no longer be a member of the team, I assembled the crew, which I'd already assembled, because I was going to put it on. I was going to stream live during the day. However, again, the Lord took over and said, no, you need to do it this way. You're going to have a lot of problems if you try and do it the other way. And one of them is going to be bandwidth, because there's nobody going to put this program on the radio. Well, some of them do. We do have several radio stations, but it's not a very high number. But some radio stations in Virginia and some out in Utah, they run it, and it's okay. But I was going to do a daytime show. You know, I was going to go from 10 until 1, middays. Well, everybody else on Coast to Coast that they had in there from, you know, the weekend host, I mean, pick one, they all had other programs that they were doing,
mm-hmm.
their own programs. But when I started, when it got out that I was going to do my own program, for some reason, I mean, somebody figured that that was a problem. But I think the whole thing, I think me just being there was a problem.
you were too good, like, actually, was the problem.
Well, I would never say that. It's kind of you to say that. But, you know, they just, you know, when it gets to the point where you got people saying, well, just don't say the name Obama. It's like, if you don't want the name to be used, and quit booking people on the program that say the name. I'm not a puppeteer.
Right.
You know, I can't control what comes out of their mouths. I'm not going to tell them to shut up or that they can't say that name. Even though I did one time, I said, wait. I said, please just don't speak that name. You know, well, that was misinterpreted also, even though not really.
Right.
Don't speak that name in this studio, on this program.
Well, I think it's a great name. I really do. And I,
yeah, that was a long answer, wasn't it?
It's fine. Well, would you like to go ahead and say the closing prayer for us, John? And I'm looking to have you back on again, you know, anytime that you want to be on or anything. So.
Okay, you call and I'll answer, okay?
Sounds good.
I'd very much like to do the closing prayer.
Thank you.
I'll do my best. Here it is. Heavenly Father, creator of everything, creator of us, past, present, and future, we come to you as humble servants who are unworthy servants, unworthy to share in this experience that you have provided us based largely on our behavior and our inability to hold fast to faith on some occasions. But through your Son, your Holy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, Yehoshua, Yahshua, Yeshua. Our sins have been washed away and we have been renewed. And all that is required of us, according to your plan, which you also invented for us, because you really do love us, despite what happens in the world, you do love us and we see this. We know that you are everywhere. We know that you are everything. And we know that you provided our Son, your Son, so that our sins could be washed clean. Our dirty robes washed to a brilliant white. And all it takes is faith that you exist, that you created us, that we have taken one misstep after another, some of them horrible, but that through the sacrifice of your Son and through belief in him, we can return home to you. Grant us the ability to see how you work. Give us the eyes to see and the ears to hear your messages to us as you are present everywhere in our lives. Furthermore, Father, I ask that for those who have no faith, if they come to you and ask that you show yourself, show them that you exist. I pray that you do this, that you show them with an irrefutable proof that you are real, that this is not a computer program or an illusion or any other kind of folly invented by man based on your creation. But you show them what is real. And you fill them with that spirit that is you, the Holy Spirit, which not by words, but just by this one action, lets them know that they belong to you, that they are wanted, that they are loved, and that they are welcome back into the family that is your family, that is you, and that they may be in your protection and under your guidance for the duration of their days, and that your Holy Son, Lord Jesus, will be waiting to greet them when they cross from this life to the next. Thank you, Father, for all your blessings and protection, those known and those unknown. Amen.
In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you again, John. That's going to do it for tonight, everyone. I want to thank you all for tuning in, and good night, everyone.